I'd like to welcome you all back to the afternoon session. Now I will be your host. My name is Siobhan Gray, and together with Professor Peggy Valk, I have devised this media forum. We are flattered to have an inspirational politician to give the keynote speech this afternoon. In keeping with the modern age, she writes a blog, of course. It's the Vice President of the European Commission for the Digital Agenda in Europe. And she writes a blog, and it's compulsory reading for anyone remotely interested in this area. Her posting today is a case in point. The future is digital. Will people embrace that change, or will they carry on as they are and hope the change goes away? It is my very great pleasure to welcome to the floor the Vice President of the Commission for the Digital Agenda, Ms. Neelie Kroes.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for your kind introduction. By the way, there is no choice. There is only a future with digitization, no doubt about that. Having said that, another statement, so to say, a one-liner. What is it to be a European? And certainly nowadays, for hectic times, very fascinating, confronted with difficult situations, but also with challenging situations. And also in that field, I would say, there is no choice. Thanks heaven, there is only a united European future. And to reflect on what Europe does best, I think we have to touch upon a couple of lines. Many see Europe as an economic union, as a single market to boost trade. For me, but that is quite clear, it's more than that, and you are not surprised to hear that. It is a place, Europe, where we come together and where we deliver for our citizens and for ourselves. And that is more than talking about economic growth. And that certainly, those days as we are in now, it makes sense to mention that it's not only about economic issues, so to say. Very important, and we have to tackle those challenges, but it is more. Here in Europe, ladies and gentlemen, we are an organized melting pot. We have many cultures, and we have a lot of histories, and we have for each other and for each other's cultures awareness, curiosity, and respect. And that is how we find unity in diversity, and that is something to be proud of. Delivering for our citizens also means safeguarding freedom. And including the freedom of speech, the right to express yourself, to dissent, and to hold the powerful to account. And outside Europe, not far from our own doorstep, we can see what it means to lose that tolerance and respect, or to be deprived of those rights. We rightly condemn when those freedoms are curtailed or quashed, from bloggers arrested in Syria to journalists imprisoned in Azerbaijan. But on the international stage, we can do more. We can do more than just make strong and strongly worded statements. We should not just say, but we should show. We should show to the rest of the world what vibrant society prospers under those positive principles: liberty, tolerance, and democracy. And then we cannot just offer those gifts to our own people, but we can light a beacon of hope to all oppressed peoples and be the world's wellspring of freedom. That needs, by the way, a strong media sector. it is a free media with professional and quality journalists who often best inform electorates, challenge authorities, and broadcast minority voices. Thus, a freedom and a free medium exercises a fundamental right, aids our mutual cultural understanding, and improves how people are governed. And those principles, dear friends, offer an opportunity for our future, and they are worth fighting for. When they are threatened within the EU's own borders, as they have been in Hungary, we should indeed protect and defend them. There are two points I'd like to make today. Number one is that a strong media sector exists within an economy and must take account of economic realities. As for so many things, pluralism cannot be guaranteed in isolation, but flourishes or withers according to the environment. As with so many sectors, the internet is radically changing that environment, transforming the economics, transforming value chains, transforming the role of everyone from journalist to paperboy. This digital revolution creates great opportunities for pluralism, but also some risks. On the one hand, it opens up a platform for every blogger, every internet user, every citizen to make their voice heard. On the other, it may make it harder to invest in long-term investigative journalism as consumers increasingly expect immediate content and access at low cost or none at all. One thing is absolutely certain. We need to adapt. Carrying on and hoping digital realities go away is no solution. Such an approach would close down new online opportunities and it would damage the sector's competitiveness and, yes, it would ultimately damage media pluralism. Today, I received the first part of the report of the Media Futures Forum, chaired by Christian von Thilo, and he is in our midst. Here we are. That forum includes those from across the sector value chain, and their report is thorough and very, very welcome. In spite of different perspectives, they recognize very clearly that in a digital age, the media sector needs to change or lose out. And I'll be studying it very closely, and I hope others will too. But already I can tell you, I'm convinced about many of the solutions they propose. Yes, we need more innovation. Yes, we need more fast broadband. And yes, we need the rules and mentality to try out new business models, models with the scale needed for pan-European success. Because in a tough global market, those technologies can give a much-needed boost to the media sector, and in fact to almost every other sector too. And to get that boost, we need the right laws, we need the right technology, and we need the right mindsets and business models. For example, look at e-books. Still today, I can't transfer my own e-books from one device to another. Still today, it is hard to buy an e-book from another EU country. And there are yet greater issues in the audiovisual world. Yesterday, we got together, those active in the e-book market, and they agreed on a common declaration on those issues. That is a great result and one example of the kind of change to mentality we really need. And like I say, one cannot ignore the economics when considering media pluralism. But in some cases, a free media faces challenges that go well beyond economics. And those situations can pose more explicit threats to liberty and democracy. And I've already referred to the case of Hungary. So that leads to my second question. It's well to talk of the importance of freedom and pluralism, but how, in detail, should we safeguard them? looking beyond the economics, what policy tools, what legal powers, what moral rights and responsibilities do we need? And that is indeed more complex than we first thought. Some say that governments should keep their hands off the media, full stop. I have some sympathy, but in some cases, positive government action can aid media pluralism. For example, sometimes governments can ensure that ownership is not too concentrated through competition policy. And sometimes, indeed, I find that people do expect public authorities to act. Indeed, recent threats to media freedom showed up a very strong general expectation that the Commission can act. But as it stands, the legal framework won't let us meet that expectation. One or other needs to adjust. And that is a key question. I want to resolve it, no doubt. Currently, the EU does not have the legal competence to act in this area as part of its normal business. In practice, our role involves naming and shaming countries ad hoc as issues arise. Year after year, I return to this Parliament to deal with a different, often serious case in a different member state. And I'm quite willing to continue to exercise that political pressure on member states that risk violating our common values. But there is merit in a more principled way forward. On the other hand, I don't want to rush to regulation. In some cases, indeed, regulation can support freedom. But if our aim is to separate the media from governments or parliaments, then the risk is that regulation does exactly the opposite. In recent cases, NGOs, journalists, members of parliament complained that we didn't have sufficient power or that we didn't intervene enough in the area. Well, they would be the first to complain if we ended up with too much power or intervened too much, and rightly so. So I've asked for advice, and the report by the Media Futures Forum is the first step. And I'm also looking forward to the advice of the High-Level Group on Media Freedom and Pluralism, led by Professor Vaira Feige-Freiberger. And I'm pleased that Ben is attending this meeting, one of the wise people out of the group. He is... Okay. To the ongoing work of Center for Media Pluralism and Freedom in Florence, and of course to the debate on media freedom standards in this Parliament. But they alone won't solve the problem, with all respect. More generally, I want a principled debate, and could it be here in this House? And I want all those involved, member states, European Parliament, NGOs, journalists and others, to contribute, frankly, contribute about those issues. And today's conference, Madam Chair, is a great opportunity. It is an important step, so to say, to start the debate. Does more need to be done to safeguard media freedom and pluralism? Who should do it? And what are the best tools to use? Some believe that the media market in Europe is too local, too fragmented for the EU to have a role. And others believe that as the EU is grounded in common values like freedom of speech, it should also protect those values. If this latter is the conclusion of our debate, I'm ready to play the part. But in any case, I want to decide a way forward before the end of my mandate. We are halfway the term in office, so still a lot can be done. And I am just looking at some of the representatives of the European Parliament to give me backing in that process, that we can come steps further than we are now. The issue of how to safeguard media freedom and pluralism is complex, no doubt about that. It will involve reflection, and it will involve hard choices. It's too important to treat simplistically. But to those who say it's too complex, it is too risky, it's too much of a headache to even think about, I couldn't disagree more. This is about democracy. It is about freedom. It is about Europe. No cost is too high to secure those aims. No level of commitment too extravagant to ensure the bacon of a free and prosperous European media, one that continues to shine in the 21st century. I need your backing, I need your thoughts, and together we can come much further than we are now. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Vice President Cruz. Just a slight amendment to this afternoon's programme, and before we begin the panel sessions, there's going to be just a short intervention by the MEP Claude Moraes, who is here today. It's rather fitting that we should have an MEP to speak on the issue of media pluralism as we're here in the Parliament, having of course heard from the Vice President of the European Commission for the Digital Agenda on the very issue. So I'd like to welcome onto the platform Claude Moraes.
Thank you. I'll speak from here. Thank you very much, Yvonne, and I'll speak from here with my colleagues. I'm an MEP after all. Thank you very much, Yvonne. I have to leave a bit earlier. It's not that I'm any better than any of my colleagues. So yeah. Thank you very much, and thank you for allowing me to speak slightly earlier. It's a big task to speak after Neelie Kroes and to speak after a commissioner, but I'll try my best. It is important for at least one of the MEPs to speak after the Commissioner, because Neelie set out the challenge, which was to say two things which are very important. One is that is this too much of a headache for parliamentary democracy to grapple with? And secondly, she said very importantly that we have one or two very powerful tools in the toolbox. And secondly, there are many powerful interests who don't want us to use those tools. And she, of course, as a commissioner in this extremely powerful area, has those tools to use. And she will constantly be being reminded not to use those tools. And suddenly the European Parliament is in a very interesting position. We're in a position where, on the one hand, we have the Lisbon Treaty, which has thrust us into a very difficult position. I come from a member state, the United Kingdom, which didn't even want us to have the Lisbon Treaty, is nudging us even closer towards perhaps even having a referendum about whether we're even going to be within the European Union. Sorry, that's just me releasing some emotion. And we're in a situation now where the Parliament itself has to make some decisions across the political spectrum about what it is we want in the area of media pluralism. So the battleground, if you like, is a very difficult one. And the way that the Parliament is approaching it is this. On the one hand, the stimulus is not coming from the competition law side. The new report on media pluralism, if you like, or media freedom, is coming from the fundamental rights aspect of our work. And the stimulus was very much the situation in Hungary. The reason we have the media report was from the Libe Committee, the Justice and Home Affairs part of the European Parliament. And the stimulus was a very tough situation of a situation that often happens in this Parliament and increasingly happens, where you have a country position, whether it's the Roma in France being expelled or whether it's another situation that suddenly grabs the media attention and suddenly puts the European Union, and I don't have to remind the Commissioner of this because the Commission have to grapple with this. In this case, Mrs. Reding had to grapple with the French situation, and another day it will be Mrs. Kroes has to grapple with it. But in this case, it was the Hungarian media law. And suddenly the Parliament had to decide itself, what does it do about this potential breach of fundamental rights? And suddenly we had to decide the kind of advice that we give to the Commission and to our electorate about whether we think that this member state has breached fundamental rights by imposing a media law which we believe breached Article 7 and breached perhaps the fundamental rights of the European Union. So suddenly we have a media report on our plate. Then we have to decide what the other tools are in the toolbox. And here we have a very difficult position because, first of all, we have to decide whether as parliamentarians we now get into the area of independent regulation, which is really a parochial situation. It's a member state situation. But then we have a panel this morning of Hugh Grant and other people. I have to say, many people who have perhaps been Eurosceptic in other lives, who are saying, but we want the European Union to say something. Why? Because very often independent member states have found it difficult to say something about regulation of the media. As he said in his contribution, sometimes it's better for the European Union to act collectively because it can act more powerfully, because it fears less. Now, for MEPs, this means that we have to have a locus, we have to have a legal base to do something, because we are also aware that we have a European Union at the moment in a context of an economic crisis, of raging Euroscepticism, and suddenly we're being asked as MEPs to start regulating in the area of media law. So the way that we approach this is, first of all, to think about fundamental rights. That's the first point. And Neelie Kroes talked about a community of values. This is where we begin. Secondly, we look at the tools in the toolbox. Of course, competition law is important. But as we saw in the BSkyB decision, and speaking as a UK MEP, I'm sorry to make this a parochial issue, but this is the case in point. With the BSkyB decision, what happens in that decision was that we make a competition law decision on what we did with Murdoch. But at the end of the day, that's a competition law policy decision, but it may not be a decision which then follows through on media pluralism. I'm not making a comment on whether it was the right or wrong decision. Of course, I happen to think it was the wrong decision, but from a competition law perspective, it may have been the right decision. From a media pluralism point of view, it may, I feel, be the wrong decision. So that gives you a view that maybe there is a gap there. Is that a gap in which we may have to step into? But then if we have to do it, how do we do it? So there are many areas in which we may not have the tools. And as you hear from our friends in the journalistic world, maybe there are areas in which we can't step into. But again, as Neelie Kroes was implying, there are people who will want us to step into this area. And let me tell you why. It's because of the Lisbon Treaty that we as MEPs are being thrust into this area. We have data protection regulation coming before us. This will be the first time that MEPs have to legislate in the area of the internet. This means that we'll have big American interests, Google and Facebook and others, lobbying us furiously because we'll be legislating in the area of the internet very soon. So this is an area that is going to be extremely difficult for us. So that means that whether people like it or not, we will be legislating in this field. There are other areas where we will have to have solutions. For example, when we look at individual press complaints, is it really possible for us to have a cross-border solution coming from the European Union? Of course, journalists would say it's impossible because there's no such thing as a European press. But again, our citizens, constituents are asking us for this. Hugh Grant mentioned it. Are we talking about citizens' initiatives in each member state? So these are the things we're being asked. But the big one, competition law, is one that we can use, and it's one that where we have to support the Commission, but it's not the solution to everything. And fundamental rights is something we will not let go of, because it's important to us, it's important for freedom of expression and to journalists. But there will be the hard cases, and the hard cases come with the digital media, with the internet. And I hate to say this to any press journalists present, but as the press printed media starts to decline, we will start to go into the area of digital media more and more. And that's going to bring hard cases. How do we regulate? And again, Neelie Kroes rightly said, we don't rush to regulation, and people don't want MEPs to start rushing to regulation. And this is where we have to tread extremely carefully and sensitively. But whether we like it or not, we're going to be thrust into this area after the Lisbon Treaty. We have to work very carefully, very sensitively. But make no mistake, for the Parliament, we will be pushed into this area. We're working in this area already on data, and we will be in this area. So we have to work together and get the solutions right. It will be very tough, it will be imperfect, but we will be in this area whether we like it or not.
Indeed. Now, before we commence our panel sessions this afternoon, there are just three matters I've been invited to raise. The first matter is there seems to have been a ticket, train ticket to Bonn, which has been lost by one of our participants. So if anybody finds a train ticket to Bonn, please don't run off with it, but if you could return it to me, I'm sitting at seat number one. The second point is, for those of you who have joined us this afternoon, that there is Twitter, and it's at hashtag NM27. Furthermore, the third point, there's also Wi-Fi in the Parliament, and the code can be picked up at the desk outside the hemicycle. So it's been worth the wait. I would like to introduce the first of the two panel sessions that we will hear this afternoon. The first panel session will be chaired by the former European Court of Human Rights judge, Vladimir Zagrebelsky. And on his panel today will be Christian van Tille, Andris Mekalokos, Tobias Schmidt, Bob Collins, Madeleine de Kock-Banning, and we hope, by way of Skype, Erica Mann. And this will be the test of the digital age, if we can link up with her. So I'd like to start the first panel session. Thank you.
Ça marche. Bon après-midi. On commence donc cette session de travail dont le titre est « Les défis doivent-ils être traités au niveau global ?» C'est une session avec son titre, naturellement, mais il y a un lien, je pense qu'il faut en tenir compte, avec les travaux de ce matin. Il y a un mot qui est revenu toujours, pluralisme. C'est un mot central dans la jurisprudence de la Cour européenne des droits de l'homme. Une jurisprudence qui lie les autorités nationales, les juges nationaux, par le biais de la Charte des droits fondamentaux de l'Union européenne, les institutions européennes de l'Union également. Dans la jurisprudence de la Cour, on souligne toujours l'importance de la liberté d'expression, du droit de recevoir les informations, donc les deux côtés, ceux qui donnent et ceux qui reçoivent, la nécessité que l'accès à l'information soit effectif et pas théorique, le fait que la liberté d'expression couvre les expressions qui sont fâcheuses, qui sont repoussées par des couches, des secteurs de la société, donc pas seulement les opinions volontairement et avec facilité acceptées. Et on dit toujours que c'est le pluralisme qui est la marque, le pilier, la condition de la démocratie. À ma connaissance, on n'a jamais dit dans la jurisprudence de la Cour de Strasbourg qu'est-ce que c'est que le pluralisme. Et j'ai l'impression que même ce matin, on a parlé du pluralisme, de l'influence sur le pluralisme des nouvelles technologies, des intérêts économiques, etc., etc. Mais on n'a pas répondu encore, et je pense que c'est le moment de le faire, avec un panel différencié comme on a maintenant, des responsables de l'entreprise, des techniciens, des connaisseurs des nouvelles technologies aussi. On n'a pas répondu encore à certaines questions. Est-ce que le pluralisme doit être assuré dans l'ensemble des médias d'un pays, qui opèrent dans un pays, ou en Europe, ou bien dans les émissions de chaque diffuseur? Quels sont les moyens de contrôler le pluralisme, de quantifier, de dire c'est assez, c'est pluraliste ou pas encore, il faut améliorer. Est-ce que le pluralisme concerne la pluralité des propriétaires des médias? Est-ce que ça suffit d'avoir d'un pays plusieurs propriétaires? Un propriétaire qui couvre le 80% des médias, c'est inacceptable. Mais est-ce que quatre propriétaires qui sont des frères et des sœurs, par exemple, couvrent le même pourcentage, mais assurent-ils le pluralisme? Ou bien même quatre propriétaires qui n'ont aucun lien de famille, mais qui couvrent le même milieu culturel, politique, économique, donc qui donnent la même information. Ils sont séparés, ils sont même en concurrence sur le plan économique. Ce sont des questions, à mon sens, de caractère fondamental pour répondre à la question de savoir si un système de médias est démocratique. Parce que la logique de la jurisprudence de Strasbourg, et je souligne, c'est une jurisprudence qui oblige les États membres du Conseil de l'Europe et l'Union européenne, la logique, c'est la protection des minorités, ceux qui n'ont pas de voix, pas de force économique pour avoir la voix dans le débat public. Et alors, et c'est la dernière question que je vous pose, est-ce que la protection des minorités, l'assurance d'un vrai pluralisme, ne renvoie pas à ce que la Cour de Strasbourg appelle les obligations positives de l'État, donc d'être actif, d'intervenir. Si la réponse doit être positive, donc il y a un rôle à jouer par les gouvernements, les parlements, les autorités indépendantes, mais les gouvernements à la fin, est-ce que c'est l'une des questions sur le background de la discussion? Est-ce qu'on peut confier au gouvernement une tâche tellement importante dans le dessin d'un système de médias pluraliste et démocratique? Ce sont des questions que, dans la jurisprudence quelquefois facile de Strasbourg, on dit qu'il faut être pluraliste sans dire qu'est-ce que c'est que le pluralisme. Ce sont des questions qui sont ouvertes. Et je pense que dans notre après-midi, dans cet après-midi, on va les aborder. Le premier qui a la parole, c'est M. Christian Vantillo. 5 minutes plus ou moins avec tolérance, mais 5 minutes. À vous la parole.
Merci beaucoup. 5 minutes pour répondre à vos questions, 5 minutes pour expliquer ce que le forum a fait. 5 minutes pour répondre à vos questions?
Non. Ah.
Well, just very quickly to answer to the first question, I think as a publisher of newspapers, pluralism is in my opinion about access to diversity of opinions in any society, and that should also be defined in local geographies, because that's how people consume their media nowadays. And as long as newsrooms have in their journalistic independence the guarantee that they're independent, I think that consolidation on the business side is not such a bad thing if we want the pluralism to continue to exist. With respect to the Media Futures Forum, in less than 5 minutes then, I was asked by Nelly Cruz to chair a group of 30 people that spoke in their personal capacities, coming from all sectors of the value chain, and the value chain being a new value chain, which has been the largest disruption in media for the last 15 years. And that is that media companies don't only, they used to produce their content to make them, to have the new, to own the newsrooms, to own the production, to own the distribution, and to send the bill and have a contact with their final consumers. This has changed. Some people call it convergence. I'd rather call it a coexistence between media companies, distribution companies, so those are the telcos, internet service providers, device makers, the Apples of this world, the Samsungs, and the real internet companies that have big platforms like Google, Facebook, and the others. There were people from all these sectors, but they spoke in their own capacity. We had four long meetings where we made an analysis of the last 15 years of what has happened in media and how this new value chain affects the media. We try to forecast what the media scene in Europe would look like in a no policy change scenario, and that was not a pretty sight for all players in the media sector. And we then asked ourselves where legislation could help to create a clear framework, a clear framework in the new value chain for all these sectors, and let it be clear that these sectors are really different. There were 8 recommendations that were published yesterday. The first being that there is a big wake-up call from all of us, and we all agreed on that, that we have to act, that we have to act urgently, that it's a market that is evolving very, very rapidly, and that current legislation doesn't, is not sufficient for the future. A digital single market will help. It will clarify a lot of things. We disagreed on some points as well. We all felt that copyrights, the copyright framework is not always clear in giving answers in the digital age, but some thought that the legislation, that there was nothing wrong with the legislation, but it's more the interpretation of it, while others thought that it's the framework, it's the copyright framework itself that should be changed. We called for to stop all discrimination between online VAT and offline VAT. Think about newspapers that are in fact disencouraged to be entrepreneurial online because their VAT rates in their print products are mostly lower, most of the time lower than what is the case in internet. We talked about privacy, was just mentioned as one of the big points of legislation as well, where we really plead for a good equilibrium, a good balance between what is good for consumers and what is good for people in the business community. A very, very important discussion was about the fairly rewarding of creators and creation of content on the internet. This is probably one of the most important things. It has to do with the question of who owns what on the internet. Once you know who owns what these rights are and what the rights of others are, and how you can enforce these. With respect, for example, of broadcasters owning the signal, their linear signal, and distributors that just can't run away with it and do whatever they want with it, or the same thing with aggregation or what have you. These are just examples. That the financial support for audiovisual creation should be adapted and coordinated was something we agreed upon as well. That there should be a level playing field on all aspects, whether it's tax regulation, advertising rules, even what was just mentioned, rules with respect to minorities, etc. There should be a level playing field between our European players and the global players, which is not always the case today, and in fact it also creates unfair competition. We have to avoid new barriers to entry in the markets, which is, you know, there is a very, the competent authorities should take effective action when they feel that developments in the digital sphere threaten competition or innovation. Those things have happened over the last 10 years and weren't always quickly responded to. Then increase the access to use of legal content. That's very important. That's the only way to ban illegal or to make sure that illegal will not be there anymore. That, and then finally, quickly roll out an infrastructure in Europe that makes it possible for our citizens to access all digital content. We were world leaders. We're not anymore now, and we should become again before 2020. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Monsieur Andris Melaklaus, who is qui est le président du comité directeur des médias de la société d'information
au Conseil de l'Europe. Vous avez la parole.
Thank you, Chair. Very interesting to listen to this morning's sessions because many of the key words contained therein are issues that are dealt with by the Council of Europe. So let me just give you an insight into what we do. The Council of Europe has 47 member states, and it has been and continues to be the pan-European standard-setting body in the field of the media and information society. In our 30 years of existence, the CDMSI, that's the acronym for our committee, has been responsible for drafting an impressive body of European instruments regarding the media, which include 27 declarations and almost 60 recommendations. Ours is a human rights and multi-stakeholder approach to standard setting. Alongside the member states, other participants in our work include intergovernmental organizations such as the EU, UNESCO, the OSCE, OECD, ITU, and even the OAS, the Organization of American States. Very important in our work is the contribution of international NGOs, such as Article 19, ACT, Association of Commercial Televisions, the AEJ, that's the Association of European Journalists, and European Federation of Journalists, and I could give you a whole list of NGOs concerned with the media, and including internet, that are very important for our work. Now, without going into detail, the terms of reference of the CDMSI reflect the changing face of the media landscape. For example, we have to oversee the implementation of the Council of Europe Internet Governance Strategy. We have to develop cooperation at pan-European level and extend this cooperation to the neighbouring regions and engage other stakeholders. We are to review, consolidate and update existing instruments and conduct where necessary additional standard setting work in respect of freedom of the media and paying due attention to professional journalism standards, independence, pluralism and diversity. It's interesting to note that among the many examples or the issues that were addressed this morning by, for example, Jeanette Mujic and Jeffrey Robertson, we have already been dealing with these issues for many years, and it's not a case of whether it's too big a headache to address these issues. This is our mandate. I'll just give you a couple of examples because time is short. Over 20 years ago, in 1991, we drafted a recommendation on measures to promote media pluralism. This was followed by recommendations on media transparency, the independence of public service broadcasting, the independence and function of regulatory authorities, and most recently, in the last 5 years, on media pluralism and diversity of media content. In 2011, we drafted a new notion of the media. This year, we have new recommendation and guidelines on public service media governance. And just in April, new recommendations on the protection of human rights with regard to social networking services and on the protection of human rights with regard to search engines. Current issues of concern are the safety and protection of journalists, tracking and surveillance technologies, and something which is a bit of unusual for us, libel tourism. So far, so good, you may say, but there's an increasing perception of overlap and possibly even duplication of our work by the work being done by the EU. This has been recognised by the Committee of Ministers when it stated, the Council of Europe should strengthen the impact and visibility of its activities in the field of media freedom through wider coordination among its various competent structures and mechanisms, as well as through reinforcing cooperation with other international bodies in this area, in particular the European Union, the OSCE and the UN. During our last plenary meeting in March, we also agreed that enhanced coordination between the CDMSI and the European Commission is desirable to ensure an early exchange on their respective proposed or ongoing work. A positive example of this was the meeting of the Commission's high-level group on media freedom and pluralism in Riga in April this year, where the CDMSI had a very useful exchange of views with the group, as Ben Hammersley will no doubt confirm. However, on the downside, when this early exchange is absent, problems are bound to occur. The Commission's assertion of exclusive competencies comes at a price. We can call them molehills on the level playing field of pan-European rules. One example is the abandonment of the review of the European Convention on Transfrontier Television. This means that in Europe there are two parallel binding instruments, the Convention and the Audiovisual Media Services Directive. EU and EEA member states and candidate states are bound by the directive. But what about the rest of Europe? Azerbaijan and Russia, for example, have not ratified the convention and can hardly be expected to be bound by an EU directive. Another example is the case currently before the ECJ, where the Commission has asked the Court to annul the decision of the Council on the participation of the European Union and its member states in negotiations for a convention of the Council of Europe on the protection of the rights of broadcasting organisations. The Commission may be acting perfectly within its powers, but these hiccups might be avoided through greater cooperation. And indeed, the need for effective cooperation between the EU and the Council of Europe is not only enshrined in law, it's an imperative. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much. Mr. Tobias Schmidt. C'est le vice-président exécutif de l'affaire gouvernementale du groupe RTL.
Thanks a lot. Chair, dear ladies, dear gentlemen, of course it's a pleasure to share some of my or our thoughts to this very important topic, to this core of a democratic media framework. As far as I understand, the top line of this panel now is that we should discuss about what is the appropriate level to address all the challenges we've heard today. Interesting question and interesting challenge to answer this in 5 minutes, because as far as I can see and show a look on the agenda and on the speakers shows it very open, and also the listening all over the day shows that we have about hundreds of different aspects of this word that we call here media pluralism. So as I'm a lawyer and a German, unfortunately, I've got to try to make it, for me, a very simple structure to handle this
system.
Exactly. We need a system. So that's why I will start with the question, what is the objective of this discussion of media pluralism? And as far as I can see and I've heard in the discussion today, I think there are minimum three different objectives, and maybe there are also three different levels where the appropriate level is to regulate or to react on. The first, of course, and this is very obvious, is that for a media pluralistic society, we need a working democratic system. That means, and there we are on this level of fundamental rights we have, to take care that and this idea of media pluralism can only work if the system in behind is based on democratic principles. This, of course, is in the responsibility of all of us. This is an international responsibility to take care that the different states, not only the member states of the EU, and I totally agree that all also the other states making the general framework. The second discussion we heard today is another one. This is very strong driven by Hugh Grant, the discussion about the question of market structure and of media concentration law. This has another objective, and this other objective maybe needs also another level of reaction. I think if we talk about this part of media pluralism, then we talk about structures of ownership. We've got to take a very close look on the different markets, and we've got to take a look on the balance in between the different media areas in one market. Let's take an example. If you take a smaller country like, for example, Latvia, maybe there the percentage that is critical is another one of ownership than in a big market like, for example, Germany. Let's take a look on a media market like Germany that is very federalist for history. This is, of course, another market than, for example, Spain, and so on. So I think that if we take a look on this aspect, then I'm sure it is not only interesting, it's an important aspect, but I have the deep impression that the regulation level of these aspects has to be a national level, because you can't fit the special situation in the different member states overall, and that's related to the market, to the national structures, and of course to the history of the market situation over there. Besides this, I think that in all member states for this topic, this media concentration topic, there will be a very intensive discussion, also like Hugh Grant said today, about the question how to count the influence of different medias on the public opinion. How can we find a system where we can see how deep is the involvement or the influence of media like broadcasting in relation to internet, in relation to radio or newspapers? That's true, and that's interesting and important, but I think at the end we have to find for that national solutions. So these solutions will be like in the Netherlands, more in the area of the antitrust law, or like in Germany, it can be a special media concentration law, but it depends. The third topic is another one, and there I see more the European responsibility and the responsibility of the European administration. Because what is media pluralism? Media pluralism at the end is the core of this democratic media society, and that this heart can beat, we need two things. On the one hand, we need the possibility that an opinion, that content, that the aspects of minorities get generated and that they get access. And the second aspect is that all these opinions, all this content, and all these different aspects get viewed, that they can get consumed by the population. So meaning, at the end, we are talking about two extremely important aspects for the whole multimedia landscape. This is access to infrastructure. It is necessary that all this content can get access to infrastructure, and here we are talking about aspects like net neutrality, frequency policy, more technical aspects. And on the other side, and this was also interesting today, of course, that we have to find a stable system that this content can get generated. And to generate content, you need a working system to generate this creative aspects, this intellectual property, because intellectual property at the end is the material we build on all this content. So to make a long story short, or to put it in a nutshell, I think if you take this third aspect, that leads to the typical European legal frameworks like the TK package, like the European discussion about net neutrality, and we should continue this discussion. And I think beside all these other aspects, these three different levels leads us to a very interesting view. It shows us on a very illustrative way that in this still convergent world, we have to learn that we can't solve and problem like media pluralism only under one perspective. We've got to find a kind of a panoramic look of all the different aspects, and therefore I think this event today is an excellent opportunity. Thanks for that and for your attention.
Bob Collins, de Irlande. Vous avez la parole, monsieur.
Thank you. Like the other speakers, I was very taken by much of the discussion at this morning's sessions. I was particularly pleased to see that there were artists and writers represented whose work is such an important part of the raw material of the broadcasting and other content that we sometimes can take for granted. I was interested by the manifestation at 12 o'clock of the object lesson in the media standards and editorial practices of some in the media, which made me wonder to myself whether these were the media we were here to protect. But leaving that aside for a second, there are perhaps three things that I would like to try briefly to bring together in these few words. The concepts that we have grown to develop in relation to the media, their application in a changing and dynamic environment, and the role of regulation in this context. 50 years ago, just a little over 50 years ago, when television was introduced in Ireland for the first time, there was a real apprehension that this could be an engine of the devil, that it would do immense damage to the pre-existing media. The President of Ireland, speaking on television on the opening night, compared its power and its influence to that of nuclear power. He may not have been as far wrong as people thought at the time. But, of course, it didn't represent the death of radio. It didn't represent the death of newspapers. And we have to be wary of gloomsayers who suggest that we are facing the death of the contemporary media just because of the fact that a new world is around us. Nevertheless, there are cold realities. And there are serious threats to the existence and the quality of a whole range of newspapers, of broadcasting services, public and privately owned. And we cannot, I think, overestimate the damage to democracy that would be caused by the loss of significant contributors to the availability of information, news and a variety of views. The Broadcasting Authority of Ireland regulates all broadcasting. It awards licences, it keeps, it monitors ownership and control positions, it distributes 7% of the television licence fee by way of a fund to promote the making of programmes for radio and television. And then what is the place for regulation in this new environment? This is a dilemma with which the European Platform for Regulatory Authorities, EPRA, struggles every time it meets. And the same EPRA operates given the reality that there are 27 distinct legislative frameworks under the single allegedly umbrella ABMS directive. We live also with somewhat uncoordinated approaches between the European Union and the Council of Europe. We see the danger that initiatives which were intended to avoid anti-competitive practices may themselves become anti-competitive, and may give rise to an unfair or at least asymmetric regulatory framework where channels located in a country can be subject to significant degrees of regulation, but those originating in another member state have no such concerns to deal with. Perhaps we need to have a much more coherent set of policies developed while preserving the capacity for individual action within member states. For me, the internet is an unambiguous good because it has provided opportunities to develop a much more broadly based marketplace of ideas, a public square where everybody can shout together, a liberty hall that at its best can be a powerful agent of involvement and participation. But we must not canonise it. We must not repose in it the litmus test of all of our principles. We must not see it as some divine intervention in our lives that must remain beyond our reach, even our regulatory reach. We must not assume that all who engage in it have our best interests at heart. We must be alive to the authoritarian tendencies, albeit expressed as defences of freedom of speech, of many of the major operators, near monopoly major operators, in the area, except perhaps when they're dealing with China. I am as wary of citizen journalists as I am of the notion of citizen doctors, which is not to say that people should not freely engage with the expression of ideas on the internet, but the notion that this should be an alternative to, or a substitute for, or worse still, a replacement of quality journalism is something that should be a source of concern to all. I think audiences are very sophisticated. They know how programmes are made. They know how editorial decisions are taken. The risk is that they may assume that comparable judgments are being made in output that appears to resemble television as they have known it. So the issues for us then are, what form might regulation take, and what are the key principles that we need to bear in mind? For me, I'm wary of a mechanistic, over-measuring approach to regulation. As Einstein said, not everything that can be counted counts. The key is the strategic significance of the regulatory framework and the need to ensure the protection of audience interests. Diversity isn't indeed about the availability of a wide range of views and opinions from which individual citizens can choose their own preferred view and can inform their views. But diversity is also about two other things, it seems to me. It's about ensuring that the voices, faces and views of the broadest spectrum of the people, of the population, are reflected in all media, which goes to the heart of the point the chairman made at the very beginning in relation to pluralism and the protection of minorities. And it's about ensuring that the whole population has equality of access in a new media environment. We have been given extraordinary access to information by the new media. The new technologies have democratised visual articulacy. Power has been transferred from the hands of the professional few literally to the pockets of the many. But they have also facilitated an infusion of anonymous poison into public debate and have created a culture of intellectual assassination, apparently without consequence. So what do I think we need in a new environment, or in this emerging environment? And I agree with those who said we've got to stop thinking about the old media and the new media. We must think about media, how content is delivered and made available to people. We need the protection of the availability of a wide range of views and opinions. We need absolutely the protection of minors and of vulnerable adults. We need some measure to protect personal data against inappropriate exploitation. We need to ensure fair competition so that the normal process of regulation of competition cannot be bypassed by those who simply choose to use a new medium to deliver the same content. We need a coherent European policy across all of its elements and all of its agents. We need to ensure that there is a capacity for domestic and European policy to keep pace with the speed of technological change. I'm not optimistic in this respect, because I think both domestically and at a European level, we have been severely unable to keep pace with technological change, and the complexity of our decision making, particularly at a European level, no matter how good the work of the high-level group on 20 years hence cannot fill one with confidence, it seems to me, at the moment. We need to understand diversity, as I've said, in its broadest sense, ensuring that the new media do not become a platform only for a section of the community, giving equality of access, and absolutely avoiding the emergence of a twin-track citizenship, where in circumstances where increasingly states wish to deal with citizens through electronic means, some will be advantaged relative to others. We need, I believe, a media policy at home and in Europe that reflects the entire media landscape, that works to guarantee freedom of access to information, that is not afraid to protect quality output, that is not afraid to be rigorous in defending media freedoms within the EU, and the European Broadcasting Union might adopt a similar view in being unafraid to assert media freedoms among its own members. And we need a regulatory environment that is flexible, that can keep pace, and that can respond to developments as they happen. The Belfast poet Louis MacNeice, in a poem, Snow, said, "World is crazier and more of it than we think, incorrigibly plural." He also said that he felt the drunkenness of things being various, while recognising that all forms of drunkenness can lead to hangovers. The drunkenness of things being various is a good motto on which to finish these words. Thank you.
Merci, merci bien.
Oui. Oui, merci. Merci bien, Monsieur Collins.
Et finalement, Madame Madeleine de Cockburning, qui est membre de la Commission des médias des Pays-Bas.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you very much. Do we need specific regulation for media pluralism in a new media landscape? This is what Peggy Valkenhagen asked me to discuss, talk about, and then with a Dutch perspective, because we are a bit of ahead of times, I would say, very proudly so. Until last year, we had specific regulation with regard to media companies' shares in one or more media markets, for instance, newspapers, televisions, and radio markets. But this was repealed, and with that repeal, media company market shares are fully subject to general competition law, and they have turned out to be rather stringent. The Dutch Media Authority provides transparency into the ownership relations of media organizations and their market shares by means of monitoring. Monitoring is a very important tool for signaling trends and developments. Relating to this, four different types of media concentration or diversity, this is also to answer your question, can be identified that may occur in media markets, namely supplier concentration, editorial or program concentration, concentration of media content, and more importantly now, audience concentrations. Regulating and monitoring of media concentrations all focus on external pluralism. The Dutch Public Broadcast Service also provides for internal pluralism. This is a system with very different opinions included in the system. There are different voices targeted at various social and religious groups in the Netherlands, and they're all built in the system, either by memberships or by target groups. And also the minorities, which are of course very important, are all in the system, all represented, and all have their airtime on the public broadcast services. And now I go to the challenges of today. Is a platform approach to media concentrations regulation still appropriate? Well, the media landscape is traditionally segmented by media type, with each type being characterized by specific technological features. This typologically is echoed in policies that are structured along the lines of traditional media types, like print, radio, and television. In many European countries, ownership restrictions exist for newspapers, magazines, radio, and TV. For newspapers, circulation criteria are in use. For television, there are either audience measures or the maximum amount of licensees that are measured. For internet, of course, this is all totally impossible. Think of the number of websites you can hold as a supplier. Is this a relevant criterion? I think not. The ongoing technological developments have enabled true convergence between all sorts of media types, and continue to create new features which integrate one medium with another. The different platforms are therefore no longer a profound basis for distinction. And is a national approach still appropriate? National boundaries are disappearing due to media companies which have become increasingly international. For instance, in the Netherlands, the largest companies are, for instance, the German Bertelsmann, the Finnish Sanoma, and the Belgian Press Group, and the British Mecom. Also, media policy should therefore have a pan-European focus. And then, liberalisation. In reaction to the convergence, the European scale, and furthermore, to help the publishers of newspapers that severely suffer from loss of advertisement incomes, a wave of liberalisation of media concentration law is started in the Netherlands, but you also see it in Spain and in the UK. Acts on media concentrations are repealed, and until today, there is not a European alternative on media concentration. But do we need such an alternative at this moment in time? Do we need such a monitor? Should we need regulation instead of monitoring? Based on our Dutch experience, we don't believe that fixed thresholds to a media company's market share are an appropriate way to safeguard content diversity on a European level. We suggest applying the flexible Dutch model on a European level, a European competition law that is able to react on strong signals based on regular monitoring, monitoring that can be done by media authorities. And that, of course, this monitoring should also be done on a European scale. Peggy Falkenhaven has made a beautiful research that gives a lot of good indicators to do actually such research on different media and concentrations. So this would be already a starting point we could use. The study on indicators for media pluralism in the media member states, it's called. And then another important point for us. The focus should be on news and opinion. And this is what I also listen by Mr. Collins and also by Mr. Tobias Strutter. This is an important way forward. The Dutch already started that. There is the Scientific Council for the Government Policy in the Netherlands that suggested a future-proof functional approach. Instead of media-type-driven policy, which is constantly changing and therefore very soon outdated, the question should be asked, what role do we find most important for the media? And that role is in media and of media is in news and in opinion, including also, of course, debate, which is extremely important for our democratic society. So, I come to a conclusion. The traditional mindset of defining media solely in terms of medium types no longer provides an appropriate perspective on the media landscape. Instead of distribution technique and supplier, content and user are becoming increasingly important and are expected to become even more so in the near future. This calls for a centrally organized European-wide... Hey kids, we're working here. This calls for a centrally organized European-wide monitoring system with national data collection. And for that, we need easy to access indicators, including audience concentration. And the focus should be more on news media monitor to monitor the opinion on a European level. So, I conclude totally. Regulating in a media market that is constantly changing is not a good idea. It is as shooting at a moving target. And as we all seen the European Championships of football, we know it's already very difficult to reach the aim in a standstill target. So, I would suggest better monitoring than regulation at this moment in time. And we can always decide to regulate when it's absolutely necessary. Thank you.
Merci, madame. Merci, madame. Maintenant, on a une connexion, un lien Skype avec madame Erika Mann, qui est le directeur pour les affaires européennes de Facebook. Et je pense que la connexion est prête, oui. Ça, ce sont les technologies.
Technology and pluralism, because even Facebook has the rules.
Yeah, on the.
The technicians need to switch the channel. Can you see me?
I can see you. Yes.
Hi.
You should turn your mics off. Okay.
Alors, pendant qu'on essaye de régler avec les nouvelles technologies, je voudrais demander s'il est d'accord à M. Andrew Duff, qui est membre du Parlement européen, s'il a des questions à poser à nos membres du panel.
Yes, Mr. President. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm not certain I've got questions, but I certainly have some comments. Some of them have been tweeted at you, but the twit wall has now disappeared too, and I would like it back if possible. I think it's quite fun, if distracting. First of all, as a liberal, as liberals, which we all are, we have to approach the rush to regulation with great care. And I'm certain that the European Parliament and Commission is far from being prepared and self-confident enough to launch a media pluralism directive. And I think that the rather confusing discussion this afternoon has rather proven the reasons why we lack bravado. I think that before we know where to move, we need more experience of a European dimension of media. Media with some exceptions, but few, is still grounded inside the national cultures and boundaries. There are linguistic reasons, of course, for that, but cultural, political and legal reasons too. The media, despite its pretension to be a global industry, is still actually parochial. It's far from being the medium that a post-national Europe needs to support and foster the growth of a serious, sophisticated, mature post-national politics. And I think this is a pity, because the strength of the European media sends out an extremely strong and clear signal to people beyond Europe that our values are pluralistic and strong. In the Arab Spring and in Turkey, for a example, the experience and travails, the troubles of the European media in keeping free are closely watched. We are an example to third countries, and it would be sensible for us to remember that as we work on building up the European dimension of media policy. It is a sad fact that, for instance, the BBC, which is a British broadcasting company that you might know, does not accept that the European Union is part of the governance of the United Kingdom. It treats Brussels as a bit of political tourism, and European Union as a foreign policy. We then have the problem of copyright law, and so far the efforts of the Union to to intervene in the area of intellectual property have been rather clumsy and have failed. We still are grounding our approach upon a concept of copyright that was created in the 18th century when printed books became commercially viable. And that seems to me to be completely implausible as we move towards the digital media. Well, what we need is a post-modern as well as a post-national approach to copyright, a sectoral approach that will confront specifically the issues of the digital media. Twitter, despite the collapse of the Twitter wall here this afternoon, Twitter is starting to be an extremely powerful tool in European politics, and I mean by that in post-national politics. But if it's to flourish, then politicians have got to learn just how to use it properly. It's a bad way of preaching. It's a bad way of displaying how important you are to yourself. But it's a splendid way of engaging in formed correspondence and followers in pithy and cryptic comment. And it's not, with respect to the Commission, just news that we need. It's a commentary. And I think Twitter is fine for that. I suspect that the 2014 elections to the European Parliament is to be the first proper Twitter election. And I do hope that what comes out of this afternoon will contribute to that exciting development. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur Duff. En réalité, vous avez donné une réponse à la question principale de ce panel. Quel est le niveau d'intervention de la régulation plutôt que poser une question? Quelqu'un veut réagir? Ou on attend la connexion avec Madame Lam? C'est le moment? Pas encore.
Alors, peut-être je peux demander à Monsieur Stephen Pearce, qui est le secrétaire général de la Fédération européenne des journalistes, de poser une question, s'il le veut.
Thank you, and I'll try to be brief. Posing a couple of questions and a couple of points for discussion. I think one of the issues that was raised by a colleague from the Council of Europe is that there are already many standards that exist and some fundamental principles laid out at the Council of Europe, but also at EU level. I think one of the questions is actually, is enough being done to enforce those principles that are already there? And that the Hungarian media law would be an example in which I think those questions could be asked. I would draw a couple of distinctions between some of the issues raised in the panel. the difference between regulating plurality of media and regulating the media are two very different questions, and I think they are sometimes confused in some of these fora, and I think it's important to distinguish between the two. Likewise, I would distinguish between the difference between the interests of media companies and the interests of journalism. And again, those two points would not always be aligned. And on the question of consolidation, for example, I suspect that there may be some differences. I think clearly that there is an agreement in principle that plurality is important, but I think there is the question of what happens in terms of quality media if plurality is lost, be that through consolidation, a loss of voices, but also a loss of resources, a greater reliance on agency and on shared copy that actually diminishes the quality of media. We've discussed intellectual property, and I think one of the things that would be interesting to look at, one of our panellists who's sadly had to leave us talked about the importance of ensuring creators get fair payment for their work, but actually plurality for many journalists is an issue for that, because they don't always have the negotiating power with big media organisations who will give them a take it or leave it option that involves them signing away their rights, be it to the written word, to photography, or to video, for example. Finally, to conclude, I think there's been a lot of discussion about new technology and new media versus old media. I think some comments we've made about perhaps journalists are not always looking to embrace these technologies. That certainly isn't true. Journalists see new technologies as a fantastic way of sourcing their stories, of disseminating their stories. But I think what is important is to keep some perspective, and Mr. Collins talked about the importance of professional standards. And I know there's been a lot of discussion here about the case in the United Kingdom, about the Leveson inquiry, the B Sky B case. And I think one of the things that's interesting for me there is there was a large amount of campaigning that took place on those questions. But ultimately, it was investigative journalism, and thanks to plurality of journalism that ensures there are different voices and the media can hold itself to account, that led to some of the stories that led to the opening up of issues there. For me, therefore, I don't think this is a question of new versus old media. It's a question about quality media, and that's what I think the debate should focus on.
Merci bien. Qui veut réagir ou répondre? À vous, monsieur.
Stephen Pearce, you're quite right. In your comment, there is a good and solid body of existing standards, but how do you ensure them? The problem with, or you may not see it as a problem, is Council of Europe instruments, apart from conventions, are what we commonly call soft law and not strictly binding. However, the European Court of Human Rights, as our chair will confirm, frequently refers to a Committee of Ministers' recommendations, and not only that, Council of Europe, the judiciary around the Member States is encouraged to refer to Council of Europe recommendations and standards. Of course, this is difficult for a post-socialist state such as my own in Latvia, but slowly but surely we are beginning to take on board these standards. That's what I have to say.
Merci bien. Monsieur Kostas Rossoglou, qui est du Bureau européen de l'Organisation des consommateurs, peut poser des questions, s'il le veut.
Thank you, Chair. I would like to come back to two issues.
Excusez-moi, monsieur. Pardon. Maintenant, apparemment, il y a la connexion. Pardon.
Yes, I do. Thank you so much for inviting me, and I have to apologize that I can't be with you. I would love to be in Brussels right now and listen to the discussion and the debate. The timing is perfect. I think we're all trying to understand how this new internet economy will evolve. And of course, we come from this from very different perspectives, depending on our background. For us, for Facebook, of course, we are more part of the new economy. Not as long established as publishers or newspapers or music industry, but I think we all try to define and develop our different business models. and our relationship with our users and how we want to see society and business evolving. And I think this unites us. So the timing is perfect. I really love to congratulate, and I hope that the outcome of this discussion will help us all to reframe the debate in a way which is good for the European market and for European citizens and for all of us, for the global citizens as well. Now, when you look into, I think what is important to be understood, sometimes when one talks about regulation, I think there's sometimes a misperception. First of all, there is already regulation. It's not that we are not operating in a world which is not regulated. Of course, it's sometimes a patchwork of regulation, and it's not always adopted to the new business models. But I think it's extremely important to understand that we are still at a very, very early phase. So when you go in with regulation, very hard regulation, and you predict future involvement of future technology and future business model, one has to be extremely careful, because you don't want create new barriers. You want to have startup companies not evolving in Europe because you have more regulation, which is not helpful in supporting this kind of new business. I think this is extremely important to understand. The second, from our side, from Facebook's side, I think it's important to understand that we have very different business model. Like in our case, we have an open platform, so everybody can use it. A small company can use it. A little hotel can use it. A local newspaper can use it. But more importantly, the big newspapers, they can how they want to use our platform. And this is extremely important, so that it's defined by individual business and not predefined, like in our case, by a company. The last point I want to make is that our platform allows a deep integration between European business and Facebook. So this, sometimes I think we have a completely wrong perception that this internet economy is driven primarily by American companies. I think one has to look much deeper in understanding the European contribution to this global market. So let me a story which we forget: Spotify, which is the number one in delivering music online, a partner on which uses the Facebook platform. Now that's a great European success story, which started in Sweden. Evolved all over Europe, and it's now the number one global company. Or take small companies, a game developer from Berlin just started a few years ago, has around 50 million users now. It was a very small company, and it hires constantly people now, and you will find all over Europe. And so it's really, it's still a pioneer. Very early phase. We have many, many, many European players. We should support these players, help them as much as we should help business models as well. So the media, the newspapers, everybody who is a part of this, internet ecosystem evolving, we should help. But we should not feel the desire to create a new regulation, which is, regulation is always good, but we have to wait carefully what we do, really help marketing a new business. Thank you so much, and all of you. Bye.
Évidemment, il y a encore quelques problèmes techniques avec les nouvelles technologies. Monsieur Rousseau, vous avez la parole encore.
Chase, I was not disturbed, but thank you.
Vous avez la parole.
Thank you, Chair. I would like to come
back. Yeah, I'm going.
I would like to come back to two issues that were raised by the panelists and concern the issue of the new gatekeepers. We have internet service providers, be it network providers or host providers, that actually are the new gatekeepers that provide consumers with access to information, to the content. But what we see, and consumers of course expect that their access to content information is neutral.
Sometimes one must do multitasking.
What we witness in Europe is that on one hand, you have the network providers that are actually integrating vertically with content providers, or some of the host providers, such as search engines, developing their own services, thus creating the risk of preferential treatment, preferential access to types of content, and discrimination of other types of content. At the same time, those same gatekeepers are the ones that governments and private entities request to filter online content, to adopt filtering technologies, to even block content. And allow me to say that if in third countries blocking is mandatory in some cases, in Europe blocking has become voluntary. There's not so much difference when it comes to the consumer. And at the same time, we say that Europe is actually at the center of attention of the rest of the world. So I would like to ask the panelists whether you think that the two fundamental issues from the consumer point of view, the one that is the net neutrality and the other the issue of blocking, online blocking, upon request by private entities or by governments, irrespective of whether there's a legal base or not, and there is a legal reason or not, are sufficiently protected at European level. Thank you.
Please.
Let me give a very short reaction on that. I think we have to think of the instrument of regulation, like your colleague from the journalist association said correctly. There is regulation of media content and regulation of pluralism. Here we're talking about regulation of pluralism in the sense that you want to regulate or want not to regulate the amount of ownership that is possible of a media company. So I think what I try to do in my talk is to focus on ownership concentration. So that's a bit a different topic than what you are discussing on now. I would like to say one more thing and then I answer your question. This morning you, Grant, said that ownership control would be a very good solution for the problem he has sketched, the problem of media companies misbehaving, acting criminally offendable. What I would say, media concentration is a regulatory instrument that would be shooting with a racket, with a rocket to a mouse, because in fact you can of course act against these media companies that do such things under criminal law or under tort law. And now this is the bridge for me to answer your question finally. Also for the gatekeepers. The gatekeepers are outside of the scope of pluralism in the sense that we have defined it this afternoon, of ownership control. The gatekeepers are very important, but we have to watch out whether we actually want a regulatory measurement for that, or that we could say we deal with what they do on a tort basis or on a criminal law basis. I would very much be in favor of leaving the regulatory aspects out and leaving it up to tort. Then again, there's another part. What you said is, yes, you said, well, the second question, well, if these gatekeepers are too fast to stop information that's there, or there's a chilling effect going on, what to do with that? If they are listening too soon to governments or large right owners, for instance, to stop information. We've seen it at YouTube, for instance. Well, the thing is that I think for that also we have a system, the e-commerce directive system, already in place. This is a bit technology dependent, but the principles under the e-commerce directive can be very well used for that. So I would say is look again, evaluate the e-commerce directive, step back and then find out if you can find a technology neutral way of regulating that.
Merci, Mr. Schmidt.
I think also in addition to that, it's a really an interesting question because it shows us that we are at the moment exactly in this period between the old logic of a content regulation and we are a step away from the question, do we need a technology regulation? And there I agree. I think the question behind it is something we've got to find the answer before, meaning first we've got to decide, is there a special kind of content or media content that has a special rule and that is out of the normal economic and technical system? If it is, then there will continue a system of obligations on the one hand and on special rights on the other hand. And that leads also to the question, if there is a special kind of content, then we need also a regime for things like net neutrality, like access, like the platform regulation. If we say no, this special kind of media won't exist in future, and this is an open question, then it's obvious that we don't need a special technological regulation for that, because then it's the logic of the economic and technical system. From my point of view, I think, as long as we have special kinds of content, for example, the broadcasting, the news of the broadcasting and things like that, as long we've got to take care that this content can reach the people, and therefore an aspect of net neutrality is extremely important. And that leads us, from my point of view, to the thing that I think that instead of the content regulation in future, we will have more and more in discussion of infrastructure regulation, and this leads from infrastructure companies, the problem of the vertical integration that you pointed out, up to the platform regulation, or the question how to handle companies like Google. They combine opinion building elements with a more technical approach.
Merci. Monsieur Miklos Schuder. Professeur à l'Université de Hong Kong, vous avez la parole, monsieur.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Time is short, and it's not the best position to be the last one in a long panel like this. I'd like to be very pointed and focused. What I'd like to share is about the multidimensional character of the concept of media pluralism, and the second is about the global applicability of the concept. So I'd like to pick up where Madeleine de Kolpanning left when she said that longitudinal regular monitoring by regulatory agencies is the way to go. And she kindly mentioned the 2009 study that was commissioned by the European Commission. It's called an independent study of indicators for media pluralism. This was a study prepared by Peggy Walke, Robert Picard, and I had the honor of working with this group. We conceptualized media pluralism in this study as a multidimensional work. It's not this aspect or that aspect, but there are many sides or many aspects that could be monitored, measured by well-defined indicators. The first one is whether a nation state, a member state, has policies, constitutional guarantees, a competition policy, media laws, to guarantee media pluralism, and whether these laws, these regulations are implemented. That's one basket, if you like, of media pluralism, and we developed many indicators to measure this. The second one, of course, is economic ownership of media. Market shares, numbers of organizations, all kinds of anti-monopoly or all kinds of monopolies. It's an empirical fact-based area where economic and market measures were developed in our study in 2009. Third area is cultural pluralism, how minorities have access to media. Do they own their media? How they are represented? Do national minorities and other cultural minorities have media representation and their own media? Of course, ethnic, but also gender minorities, gender representations would fall into this third basket of cultural pluralism or cultural diversity in the media. The fourth basket would be geographic pluralism. To what degree a national media system is monopolized by the capital, by the center, or to what degree cities, villages, regions have their own constituencies, shares, audience segments, both in terms of external and internal pluralism, representation and external media systems out there. And of course, political pluralism would be the fifth basket. To what degree different political orientations, socialists, liberals, greens, nationalists, are represented or have their own media systems in a country. And finally, the sixth basket that we developed concerned pluralism of media types, media genres, media platforms, which could be measured by content analysis and also the analysis of platforms. So the point I would like to make is that such a multidimensional measurement tool with hundreds of indicators actually is available. It's public domain. It's published on the DG Information Society website of the European Commission since 2009. Of course, it's not perfect and 3 years passed, but it can be amended. New indicators could be developed as the target is moving, the measurement tool, the targeting tool could be moving or developed too. For some reason, unfortunately, this rather comprehensive tool was never implemented for any member state. But I would like to say that either for Italy or Hungary, my home country, it could be implemented by any regulatory agency, national agency, by any journalism association, academic group, professional organization, concerned citizens groups in an amended format. Once again, it's public domain. So also, if the European Commission or the Parliament decides to support, to sponsor a pan-European project in which all 27 member states could be monitored with this tool or with an updated tool, it could be done anytime. And then we could talk about facts, not just policy aims or political arguments, but it could be a fact-based, comparative, and longitudinal discussion. The second and last point I'd like to make refers to the original title of our panel, which is, quote, "The world. Is global the appropriate level to address the challenges?" So I'd like to go global and ask to what degree the concept of media pluralism and the indicators could be universally applicable. Of course, according to democratic liberal philosophy, these are universal values. But if we look at countries like China, the question becomes very complex. 3 years ago, I moved to Hong Kong, and at the University of Hong Kong, we formed a research group in which Peggy Walker, Robert Picard, and others from the original European team are present, and we collaborate with Chinese scholars, and we try to develop a similar multidimensional measurement tool for measuring media pluralization in China, to use the concept and the indicators in a totally different environment. And I would just say a few words about this. One concept that we use is media diversification, which does not equal media pluralism. Because media diversification refers to the pluralization, to the numerical pluralization of media genres, platforms, media types. They could be very diverse. But this doesn't mean media pluralism, which is a more value-oriented term. Also, audience segmentation doesn't equal media pluralism. Because take China, you have a huge amount of capitalist organizations targeting extremely segmented groups in magazine markets or television or radio markets, with extreme audience segmentation, extreme geographic segmentation, but it has little to do with actual media pluralism. So our work in progress would suggest that media pluralism is not a pronounced policy aim, then media pluralization could be an unintended empirical consequence, an unintended consequence of media policies, but not media pluralism in the classic European sense. Media pluralization is very important in China in the online world, where users and censors play a cat-and-mouse game in their communication. Social media and discussion forums are very important to spread independent information about human rights issues, environmental issues, even mobilize for environmental causes. So one can really catch true media pluralization in the online world. So in an authoritarian system, it may happen in a highly censored system, it may happen that only social media is the sphere of real media pluralization. Thank you very much.
Merci bien. Merci pour les informations très intéressantes que vous avez données et aux réponses que vous avez données à quelques questions que vous avez posées au commencement de notre session. Je pense qu'on est arrivé à la fin et on est un petit peu en retard. Je remercie beaucoup tout le monde qui a eu la patience et la disponibilité de participer. Et je laisse la place à la session suivante.
We're now going to commence our second panel session, and it will be the last panel session of the day. I hazard a guess, but I anticipate it to be slightly shorter than the last panel session. And then we will close up with some remarks for 15 minutes, just highlighting the themes of the day and drawing the threads together. And then, of course, there will be a drinks reception from 6 p.m. till 8 p.m. So I'd like to welcome the final panel session of the day, which is to be chaired by Miklós Levé from the Hungarian Constitutional Court. And on the panel today will be Ben Hammersley, Milos Csuecse, Jean-Paul Philippot, Heather Blake, and Verica Rupa. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. Good afternoon. This is the third panel. My name is Miklós Levé. I'm the member of the Constitutional Court of Hungary. So it's a great honor for me to be here, and I think it's an honor for the Constitutional Court of Hungary. So the theme of the panel, Web, How to Create a Web of Diversity. The aims of this panel to discuss the following questions. What can we learn from industry best practices or grassroots initiatives? What can users themselves do to enhance a pluralistic and democratic discourse via the new media? And the final question, how are journalists coping with the challenge of showing the citizen the way through the information abundance? We have five panelists: Ben Hammersley, Milos Csuecse, Jean-Paul Philippot, okay, and Heather Blake, who step into the panelists because Edwin Planet unfortunately cannot come, and Verica Rupert. Now I call upon the first panel, Ben Hammersley, and just a few words about Ben from his bio. So Ben, as you may know, because he made an intervention in the opening session, a member of the European Commission High-Level Group on Media Freedom and editor-at-large of Wired magazine, the UK Prime Minister ambassador to Tech City, London's internet cluster, and an international writer, speaker, and broadcaster on the effects of the internet on society. Okay, Ben, take the floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And try that again, shall we? Thank you very much. And congratulations to everybody who's made it through this so far in the afternoon. We're almost at the drinks, so bear with us for the next half hour or so.
Cool session.
I think that I just want to speak for a few minutes and then get us back onto schedule, really. But there are some issues that I'd like to raise, speaking personally rather than speaking as a member of the high-level group or anything else official. It always strikes me that when we talk about media plurality and media freedom, that it's a topic which is so wide and so important that it enables everybody, no matter where they come from, whether they come from media, they come from new media, whether they come from government, the European Commission, the European Union, whether they come from NGOs, it enables people to put their own favorite topic, reframe it under media freedom, and then bring it into the discussion, which means that the discussion ends up being very, very wide and not very deep. And one of the things that I've noticed specifically today, as I've been listening to everybody speaking and talking to people in the breaks, has been a growing frustration in my heart about the things I've been hearing. Because I've been hearing the same arguments in conferences for maybe 15 years now. I've been a technologist for that long and speaking all the way around the world, and you hear the same things everywhere you go. That there's this thing called the internet, it's coming, it's going to do us some harm, and we have to do something about it. I think the most important thing that we can do today, the most important thing we can do as a group, and the most important thing we can do as individuals, is to stop saying that. It's been 15 years. You've been chased down the street by a snail. It is now time to admit that all of these arguments are over. Because what we face at the moment is a major political and media crisis across Europe. We don't have a crisis of media plurality. We have a crisis of trust. And the crisis of trust is not in the media. It's in the media and the political system together. Because from an ordinary civilian on the street, from an ordinary non-politician, non-media person, as all of the Levinson Inquiry has shown, it seems to me that the average person on the street doesn't see the difference between the media and the political class. It's all of one grouping. Grouping together in which trust has been lost. So when we talk about media plurality and the trust of the media and regulation of the media and all of those things, we also need to look at ourselves as politicians and as policymakers with the same critical light. Otherwise, we end up with a slightly patronizing tone that seems to come out throughout these meetings, throughout these discussions, on the idea that if it was only that we had a free media, if it was only that the media plurality was universal, then the democracies around Europe would finally understand what it was that I, as a politician, was saying, and they would support me. And this idea that we can blame a non-plural media, or we can blame a new media destroying the old media or something like that, as being the cause of all of the problems, is tiring and patronizing to everybody who isn't in this room today. But the same thing comes from the media companies. I've lost track of the number of conferences like this that I've been to where old media companies, in their talk about media plurality, are actually basically saying, please save our business model. And they redefine all of these additional things, for example, opinion, which has been talked about a lot today, as being the sole responsibility of the print and broadcast press. This just isn't true anymore. It hasn't been true for maybe 6 or 7 years. And yes, okay, some people today have mentioned Facebook and Twitter in a way which reminds me of my parents talking about rap music. But Facebook and Twitter, again, are also not where political discussions and political opinion are formed online. We have to understand, before we talk about media plurality, and certainly before we get into the core question of this panel, about how practitioners can promote plurality, we have to understand precisely what is going on in the real world. And I don't believe that's the case. So my solution to all of this is one of education. Education, yes, of the average person on the street, educating them about media, educating them about searching, educating them about media sophistication, about how to read newspapers critically, and all of that. But we also need to educate the political and media class about what everybody else is doing with their lives. We find ourselves in this glorious building, a temple to democracy across Europe, the plenary chamber of the European Parliament. And of those of you, the very few of you who brought laptops will find, there aren't any power sockets at any of the seats. That itself is the most glorious metaphor for the problem that we face today. It isn't that we have media plurality problems. It's the fact that the very people that we have entrusted with our future don't understand our present. Thank you very much.
And our next speaker is Miloš Čilić from Serbia. And a few words about Miloš. also an associate of Beskanik. I'm not sure this is the good pronunciation.
Beskanik.
Beskanik, thank you. Is a Serbian non-profit media outlet, community of regional independent journalists, Miloš, and opinion makers. Okay, Miloš, take the floor.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to underline one, let's say, problem that we are facing in our mutual communication. As you know, I'm coming from Serbia, and this communicational problem is repeating itself every time when I speak with anyone who is not coming from the Balkans or from Serbia. The thing is that we use the same words, we use the same terminology, but by these words we mean very different things. For example, when someone from European Union talks about freedom of expression, and many of speakers did that today, the point of view is so much different when you compare it with one that addresses actual problems that many Balkan countries face every day in this field. So the difference is huge, and that huge difference between our media sphere and yours, we somehow try to bridge it. We use the internet and the new media to bridge it. Ben said that some people regard new media as a threat, and I think that new media is our only chance, looking from a Serbian perspective. So the problem is that we have basic problems with freedom of expression, and I think that you should know that. During this forum, I heard a lot of well-explained statements about improving state of media freedoms in countries from the European Union, and many useful suggestions for their improvement. But you have to understand that these topics and these problems are dreams from the future for us. We are, I'm afraid, still talking about the basics. We are still fighting for free media and freedom of expression, and I will illustrate that. Serbia is basically a media-controlled country. That statement may sound bold, but it's true. All of our biggest and most influential media outlets are controlled or, in the best cases, severely influenced by political parties or individuals who are close to some political options. In May this year, just before general election in Serbia, a group of experts published a report based on standards proclaimed by the Council of Europe regarding media freedoms. Report stated that only 4 out of 27 European standards regarding media freedoms are fulfilled in Serbia today. Southeast Europe media organizations said that auto-censorship in journalism in Serbia became a rule in everyday media life. How is that possible? Well, that's the consequence of our restrictive law on media, which was written, adopted, and supported by the Democrats and the ruling parties. It was even supported in Parliament by liberal opposition. That law brought even more confusion and chaos in our media sphere, and more importantly, it de facto proclaimed auto-censorship in our media life. I would like to mention the most important report that will paint you a picture about the state of media freedoms in Serbia from the last year. It was issued by Anti-Corruption Council, and most briefly, the report reveals that we don't actually know who owns the vast majority of media outlets in Serbia. Of course, the light of very founded suspicion falls on politicians and the most influential men in Serbia who are interconnected in a common mechanism of power, wealth and influence. For example, the biggest advertising agencies, which are essential for commercials from which media outlets gain their income, are owned by a group of people and by a mayor of the city of Belgrade and a group of people close to former Serbian president and now candidate for Prime Minister, Mr. Boris Tadic. Serbia is a deeply corrupted country, and corruption is obvious in almost every single part of our public life. But one of the circles of corruption that strangles our media freedoms is especially frightening. Also, we are talking today here about pluralism, about media pluralism, and there is an illusion about pluralism in Serbian media because we have a lot of radio stations, a lot of TV stations, a lot of printed editions of newspapers, and considering only that fact, it is most unusual that on a daily basis we receive the exact same news from all of them. So we live in a media-controlled country. Some of us use the internet and new media as a tool of subversion, I would say. By using internet, we see a chance to break that uniform sound that surrounds us. And just few websites in Serbia are available for content which is uncensored or critical towards government or other institutions. One of them is Peščanik or The Hourglass. In English. In the same time, we have a growth in popularity regarding internet usage in Serbia. Unfortunately, our people have computers, but they don't know how to use it. 50%, that's half of our citizens, have compulsory education only or are functionally illiterate. 40% of households own a computer, but only 15% of them use the internet once a week. Of course, our government doesn't want to change that. Our educational system isn't internet-friendly. Most of our kids learn how to use modern tools of communication on their own. Maybe it will be a funny fact for you here, but, for example, we are still waiting our government to enable us internet shopping in Serbia. We don't have a PayPal. Just like in Russia, the situation is very similar to Russia, and just like in Russia, our political class is aware what kind of danger is ahead, is everyone is literate enough to use internet and make educated decisions. When people become more educated, more informed, and more politically aware of their situation, the next step is naturally change in opinions towards the government and political class in general, and we can all assume where's that leading to more free, more educated, more demanding citizens with lots of questions and lots of attitudes. I have no illusions, none of the world's governments like that, but Serbian government is especially sensitive to that as they see it threat to their position and their power. And I will conclude with the most fresh example. During elections held last month, political class didn't count, as I said, just like in Russia, they didn't count on informatically self-taught citizens who during election campaign made a huge difference informing themselves and connecting with each other through the internet and new media. For the first time, we gathered online, not in the streets, and you probably know how many times we gathered in the streets during the 90s. So we broke that tradition, and I think that's good. As a result of that protest online, for the first time in Serbian political history, we had a significant number of blank votes on presidential elections and elections for parliament. Institute of blank voting is totally unknown in our political culture. This year we managed to spill the initiative from the internet to mainstream media who are controlled and show its power. So blank voting, I think it's a good example as an initiative that showed how we can use internet and new media to bring some actual change and break that uniform sound from all around the place. It's not much, but I think it's a beginning, and it's a good one. Thank you. That's it.
Thank you, Miloš. I know that you have to leave, but
yeah.
Would you have 2 or 3 minutes more?
Yes.
In this case, I would have a question. Okay, my question is, what could the EU do to improve state of media freedom in Serbia and support independent online initiatives?
Well, European Union and the relation between European Union and Serbia is very complicated, but European Union can do a lot. You can make a pressure, a political pressure, and that's very useful in our case. European Union decided to give candidacy status to Serbia this year, and although our economy is in a catastrophic state, most of our prominent economy experts say that we are looking to another Greece scenario if our government doesn't apply very restrictive regulation, and I don't believe that anyone would like another Greece in Europe, just in the neighborhood. So European Union can do a lot, because our political elite works exclusively on the pressure from the outside. We cannot do much from the inside, and that's, I believe, very obvious. Our efforts aren't simply enough. We annoy them, that's true, but the real power of influence is in hands of European officials. During the process of negotiation regarding Serbia's membership, everything, I believe, can change. And in that process, we see not only the opportunity, but a real chance to bring or to restore our democracy and to improve our media freedoms, I think, from the scratch. So as far as I'm concerned, I will, and Pešćanić will continue to do just as what we did so far. So we will continue to protect that narrow space of freedom, of online freedom, and allow different voices to be heard. In other words, we would bark when they are against the values of democracy. Pešćanić basically does that. We bark and we pretend to be watchdogs, protecting that little space of freedom left.
Okay, thank you. How many minutes do you have?
I have five more.
Okay.
I'm sorry, you know, understandably there aren't many flights to Belgrade from Brussels, so I must leave if I want to catch the flight. Believe me, I would like to stay, but...
Okay. Yeah. Anybody would have a question to Miloš? No? Okay. Yes. Okay.
Hi, my name is Marietje Schaak. I'm a member of this parliament. Just would like to ask you how you think the EU can do more to ensure that Serbia complies, not only in official criteria, but perhaps in incentives or perhaps through civil society or other more creative ways, because I think what you're addressing is very, very serious, and we need to take our responsibility, because we do hope that Serbia will move towards a European future, including the media framework that is a part of that in principle, not in all member states, unfortunately.
I have a lot of examples how grassroots initiatives, what are they doing in Serbia right now? And I think your question is very important, because we need to do everything we can to improve our media freedoms from our side. But it's simply not that easy if you have a very restrictive law, if you don't have any idea who owns the media. The creative people from Serbia and the political activists and internet activists are now very popular, because they are saying something online, because they don't have they are not granted time in mainstream media to say anything about anything. So I think that for example, Pešćanić is doing public promotions and debate throughout Serbia. One of our activities is publishing books, so we published 30 books so far, and we are going to promote them all around the place and to talk about some actual problems and day policy, let's call it that way. So at that gatherings and on that debates, I saw a lot of people who are willing to do something about everything I said. We just need not a policeman to say to us what to do, but I think that our government needs a little push in direction of improving our media sphere for starters.
Okay, thank you very much. And I think all of us want the fair pronunciation of Peskanik.
Yeah.
And thank you for your speech and,
yeah,
and answers.
You.
And have a safe journey.
Thank you. I would really like to stay, but I need to catch
okay,
a flight.
You can stay.
Have a nice evening. Thank you very much.
Okay, our third speaker panelist is Jean-Paul Philippot. Jean-Paul Philippot, since February 2002, the general administrator of the Radio Television Belge Francophone, the public broadcasting organization of the French community of Belgium. Since 2009, Jean-Paul has been the president of the European Broadcasting Union and has recently been elected for a third-term mandate. Jean-Paul presents his paper in French. Okay, take the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes, I will do that in French. I'm more confident. Je pense que j'ai une première question à adresser. C'est le titre même de ce panel. On parle de diversité sur le web. Je pense que lorsqu'on parle de diversité aujourd'hui, il faut parler de diversité dans un environnement multiplateforme. Le web ou les nouveaux médias en font certainement partie. La presse écrite, la radio, la télévision en font également partie. Et ensemble, ils constituent à la fois un enjeu, je pense que d'autres panélistes l'ont exprimé tout à l'heure, et notamment dans les conflits entre médias. Et d'autre part, ils constituent également une extrême grande richesse. Je vais parler au nom des radios et des télévisions publiques européennes. On a adopté à l'unanimité de nos membres, nous sommes plus de 70 membres, qui concernent l'Europe politique, mais l'Europe géographique au sens large du terme. On a adopté à l'unanimité tout récemment une déclaration sur nos valeurs principales. Dans cette déclaration, nous parlons d'universalité, d'indépendance, de diversité et de, le terme anglais peut-être plus nuancé et plus riche que le terme français, d'accountability. Dans cette déclaration, nous prenons un engagement de jouer un rôle spécifique pour garantir la liberté d'expression et pour partager un point de vue pluraliste. Et nous exprimons également notre perception de notre responsabilité à jouer un rôle pour créer une sphère publique dans laquelle tous les citoyens peuvent former leur propre opinion et développer leurs propres idées. Je pense que dans le panel précédent, un intervenant disait que les médias traditionnels devaient se réveiller et qu'il ne fallait pas ni opposer les uns aux autres, mais ni se tourner dans des postures protectionnistes d'un passé de l'univers des médias qui est aujourd'hui révolu. Dans cette charte que nous avons adoptée, on parle également d'innovation et d'excellence. Je pense qu'aujourd'hui, les opérateurs de radio et de télévision publiques ont compris et acceptent le challenge de cette révolution numérique et y voient une opportunité de développer une relation beaucoup plus diverse avec notre audience en général et chaque citoyen en particulier. Depuis 10 ans, j'observe dans mon pays, à la VRT, la radio-télévision flamande ou la RTBF, un développement et un enrichissement de nos plateformes sur les nouveaux médias pour supporter et compléter nos contenus en radio et en télévision. Et donc, vous ne nous entendrez pas parler autrement du web et des nouveaux médias comme d'un outil fantastique pour adresser une audience plus large et pour créer une dimension nouvelle à nos métiers qui est celle du débat interactif. La télévision et la radio connectées, qui sont le futur de nos médias, constituent un pas encore dans ce sens. La diversité gagnera certainement de ces nouveaux outils. On ne peut pas parler non plus de nouveaux médias et de médias d'information aujourd'hui sans parler des réseaux sociaux. Les réseaux sociaux, c'est une opportunité nouvelle. Une opportunité nouvelle pour nos journalistes, pour s'informer plus régulièrement, pour rester connectés avec leur audience, pour délivrer de l'information en temps réel, pour commenter et réagir à l'actualité. Ce ne sera pas un substitut au travail du journalisme. On parlait tout à l'heure de formation. La formation des professionnels des médias est aujourd'hui nécessaire et c'est une demande adressée comme un soutien des services publics. Dans ce débat sur les nouveaux médias, dans ce débat sur l'information, il y a une réalité. Il n'y a jamais eu autant de sources d'information disponibles. Mais quand on parle d'information, on sait, et il faut le rappeler, quantité n'est pas synonyme de garantie. En tant que service public, nous cherchons à défendre et mettre en place un certain nombre d'outils qui nous sont propres, de manière à garantir aux citoyens que nous soyons, que nous devenions ou que nous restions un point de référence, un point de confiance, on en parlait tout à l'heure, dans cet environnement médiatique de plus en plus large. Ces outils, ils sont au nombre de quatre. L'indépendance dans la manière de choisir nos sujets et d'organiser notre prise de décision éditoriale. Un financement suffisant pour payer des équipes de professionnels, en particulier des professionnels du journalisme. Des guidelines éditoriales et un code de déontologie strict auxquels nous nous engageons. Et l'engagement éditorial d'avoir une approche pluraliste. Ça passe par des garanties d'indépendance que les services publics doivent nous délivrer, un financement suffisant pour nous garantir une indépendance économique et enfin une régulation forte, mais qui soit le fait de régulateurs indépendants. C'est dans ce sens-là que nous voulons agir. C'est dans ce sens-là également que nous continuons à produire des contenus originaux dans la diversité de nos cultures et de nos langues. Aujourd'hui, quand on fait la somme des émissions d'information dans tous les domaines produites par les services publics, on constate que c'est près de 40% des contenus offerts par les services publics qui parlent de l'information au sens large. On parlait tout à l'heure d'éducation média ou de media literacy. C'est un engagement que nous prenons et c'est un engagement qu'en tant qu'union professionnelle, nous soutenons. Nous étions il y a quelques semaines en séminaire avec des représentants de la Commission européenne sur le sujet. Pour garantir ces éléments dans l'espace et dans le temps, il y a un certain nombre de conditions à rencontrer. Au-delà d'un cadre régulatoire qui nous garantisse indépendance éditoriale et indépendance économique, il y a quelques clés qui sont aujourd'hui sur la table et qui concernent les niveaux de pouvoir au niveau européen. Au premier rang duquel, la neutralité du net et l'accès à un Internet ouvert. Nous allons basculer prochainement dans la télé connectée, dans la radio connectée, la protection de l'audience, la protection du citoyen, comme la protection des créateurs et des éditeurs de contenu doit être assurée et garantie dans un monde qui va où va cohabiter des opérateurs de radio, de télévision ou de presse écrite et des opérateurs du net, deux univers avec un cadre régulatoire, une histoire et une définition du pluralisme qui est très différente. Deuxième condition à rencontrer pour nous, c'est l'accès demain à un spectre hertzien large. Il est paradoxal de parler de spectre hertzien lorsque nous parlons d'Internet, mais nous pensons fortement que le pluralisme et l'accès universel sera garanti demain par le broadband et par le broadcast. En les opposant sur un combat sur le partage du spectre, je pense que nous sommes en train d'appauvrir les conditions du pluralisme de demain. Quatrième condition, après les conditions d'accès, de neutralité, d'accès libre et de spectre, c'est la modernisation du système de copyright. Nous sommes aujourd'hui arrivés à la fin d'un mécanisme qui rend difficile l'enrichissement des contenus digitaux par une complexité toujours plus grande de clearance des droits pour les médias numériques. Et enfin, on a parlé tout à l'heure et à de nombreuses reprises du contrôle de ce pluralisme. Nous constatons, comme les autres, que nous avons aujourd'hui, dû à cette économie et à cet environnement numérique, une évolution vers des groupes qui se concentrent de plus en plus. Le nombre de groupes agissant dans le domaine des médias diminue d'année en année. C'est un constat que d'autres que nous faisons. Des nouveaux opérateurs accèdent à notre environnement avec une puissance et un pouvoir important. Nous demandons deux choses. Un, de la transparence dans la structure capitalistique et propriétaire de ces groupes. Et je pense que avoir au niveau européen des observatoires qui garantissent que nous pouvons avoir un tracking et une transparence sera un outil au service de tous les citoyens pour mieux comprendre les enjeux derrière l'expression de ces groupes. Et deuxièmement, une clarification, une analyse plus fine des flux financiers, puisque dans l'économie ancienne, les flux financiers passaient du marché des opérateurs publics directement vers les créateurs de contenu, journalistes ou acteurs de la sphère des médias. Dans l'économie digitale, ces flux financiers servent d'autres fonctions, avec, on pense, à la clé un risque d'appauvrissement du secteur de la création. Merci beaucoup.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jean-Paul, for your presentation and speech. And our next speaker, as I mentioned, Heather Blake. In your booklet, you can find another name, Edwy Plenel, but unfortunately he couldn't come. And Heather was invited as a discussant. And we are so glad that she accepted a new position. And so she will be the fourth speaker of this panel. Just a few words about Heather. Okay. She became the UK Director for Reporters Without Borders in 2011. She was reporter for policy reports on responsibility to protect the UN Human Rights Council review and is working on her on the occupied Palestinian territories. Heather advises governments and the UN on human rights issues primarily throughout the Middle East and the North America. Please take the floor.
Thank you very much, Speaker. It's an honor to be here. It's my first time speaking in the European Parliament, and I was honored when I was asked very last minute to become one of the speakers. My perspective on this is going to be perhaps very different than what we've heard today. It's from the NGO perspective, from the humanitarian perspective. And the viewpoint is one of advocacy. I'm representing not just me, but NGOs. When they come to conferences like this, they represent the journalists, the citizen journalists, the netizens, the bloggers, who don't find themselves here, but are either outside these walls protesting in the flesh or online. And so when our organization has meetings with lots of journalists, and that's new and traditional media, particularly those not from Europe but from places like the Middle East and North Africa and Asia, and they hear in the press about Europe regulating the media, or thinking about regulating the media, or the UK thinking about regulating the media, they always get slightly worried because so many of them look to the West to set the precedents for media plurality. And it is very important what laws are made here and in the United States so that we uphold ultimate media plurality. And we do set the precedents for those journalists, and that includes bloggers and citizen journalists and netizens who are persecuted for practicing the human right to freely express their opinions. I had the privilege of attending the cyberspace conference in London in November. And I'm just going to quote Roger Wilkins, the Australian Secretary Attorney General, when he was giving a very eloquent talk on freedom of expression on the internet. And he said, he summed it up by saying that we needed to maintain total freedom on the internet. And that is, for the most part, the NGO stance. That is pluralism. And I've tried to piece together a few things that we talk about when we do meet with governments and the UN and journalists from all over the world. And one of the things that we talk about is that freedom of press and information, this includes new media, is a human right. That freedom of press and information are key components of good governance because it shows that the human right of freedom of press and information are respected, and that includes online as well. And when they are respected, the individuals that facilitate the open exchange of information, whether locally or internationally, are respected for their profession as civilians with the right to life. And this right to life has recently come into play because the journalists being targeted since, I think it's been since 2005, is on the rise. And we have seen this starkly throughout the Arab Spring. So the right to life comes into play because when there is no respect for freedom of information and press, the facilitators are targeted. And one of the ultimate ways of silencing journalists, and that's new and traditional journalists, is to execute them. Journalists throughout the Arab Spring, but not just throughout the Arab Spring, but also we've heard the editor-in-chief from the New Times in Russia speak about this, and my colleague from Serbia spoke about problems as well. Journalists that deal with these very difficult situations are defenders and promoters of human rights through reports on the radio, television, newspaper, and internet. The world's attention is brought to the uprisings and violence that take place, and we have seen taking place over a year now, making the international community aware of what has been taking place throughout MENA, has ensured and promoted the protection of life during such conflict. The crackdowns which have taken place against protesters, traditional and new media people and organizations, have been a shocking wake-up call to the length at which some regimes will go to silence opposing voices and the total disregard to any human dignity. Such actions have shown the international community just how vital and powerful information and the new media platform is. It also has shown the vast potential that it has to integrate and amalgamate opinions, cultures, opportunities, information, people, aid in policy, and print at the touch of a button. So another question that we are normally asked about is how do states or the international community make sure that there are mechanisms in place to uphold pluralism? And in this case, we're talking about pluralism on the internet. One way is through legal frameworks. And a lot of times it comes down to local law and international law, or local law versus international law. And our motto is that local law has to adhere to international standards. And according to international standards, international human rights law and international humanitarian law, found in UN Resolution 1738, and the Geneva Conventions and the UN Declaration of Human Rights, Article 19, guarantees the human right to freedom of press and information and guarantees the human right to life for the individuals that facilitate this information. The legal frameworks protect journalists from violence committed by state or non-state actors, armed forces, or any others. The function that journalists perform, and this includes citizen journalists, is non-threatening And regardless of whether a state or any opposing force agrees or disagrees with what is being written, such observations are to be kept neutral and are there to inform society for ultimately better governance. On a UN level, such is the importance of this human right and recognition of violations taking place with censorship and targeting journalists that the UN has put this human right at the pinnacle of the mandates of the Special Rapporteur for Freedom of Opinion and Expression and Human Rights Defenders. And Frank LaRue is the UN Special Rapporteur for Freedom of Expression, and his report was published last week. I'm sure many of you have read it. To quote him, he wrote, "An attack against a journalist is not only a violation of a journalist's right to impart information, but also undermine the right of individuals and society to seek, receive, and impart information." He also wrote that the internet has become an essential and economic medium for the dissemination of news globally. He has pointed out, he has also spoken about trends of violence against journalists in both conflict and non-conflict situations, and he includes citizen journalists in his report as well. He has warned the international community to be aware of ongoing repression of journalists and media freedom worldwide aimed at suppressing information deemed as inconvenient. He's warned against the abuse of anti-terrorism legislation to curb freedom of press globally, and the focus on how local journalists continue to face daily challenges. And I've just received something saying my time's up. But I'd like to end with this quote about pluralism, and I think it's brilliant. Pluralism underpins the strength of a nation's freedom and is not tested in the perfection or the sanitization of its media, social media platforms, but tested in how freely and safely an individual can move within the imperfections of true democratic fervor. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather, for your extra job as a panelist. And before moving to our fifth panelist, I ask anybody would like to raise a question? Yes. Okay, our discussion.
Well, it's...
Mr. Morten Lokagard, MEP.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. Yes, it's... I'll finish with a question. I have some few remarks on what's already been said, and also some remarks concerning the topic that we actually are supposed to discuss in this panel. First of all, my name is Morten Lykkegaard. I'm the Vice Chair in the Culture Committee in this great house, and 2 years ago I was the author of a report about the journalism and new media and how to create, if possible, a European public sphere, assuming that there was no one, a public sphere, that's to say. So that's the reason I also are very much in favor and supporting an event like this, and congratulations for having it. Having said that, I also think that I very much support the remarks from Ben Hammersley. I think that in too many conferences, one recognizes that it's quite a broad discussion where the problems are debated, not in depth, but a lot of different positions are made. I'll try to take up the question that's actually asked in this session. What can we learn from the industry best practices or grassroots initiatives? In my report, in the creation of a public sphere in Europe, I try to address several levels, several problems or layers, also the social media. I don't see, and I totally agree with Mr. Hammersley here, I don't see this discussion as an either-or. I think that we just have to get used to the fact that we have social media. It's already these 3 years I've been member of this parliament, we have been more used to use these medias, and I think that this development will continue, not as fast as someone would like to, but it will. Of course, because we will get members to learn about it, and then we will, of course, start to use it. Some of us more than others. But anyway, the very good question here is, what can we learn from the initiatives that grassroots actually use these media for? And the best example I can come up with right here is, of course, the ACTA case. I mean, for most of us in this parliament, it was a big surprise, I can tell you, a big surprise, just to be spammed by thousands of mails and interventions on the social media, and to realize that we have created something like ACTA, and this was a wake-up call, really, and looking at what we have achieved in this, that's to say, to stop the ACTA in this current form, I think that this is actually turned out to be a great success for the grassroots, for the public movements, and certainly it was a wake-up call for us as parliamentarians. So that is probably the best example I can come up with right now on the use. Having said that, I was also totally frustrated about what I experienced, because, I mean, I had approximately 200 to 300 mails each morning when I came to work, on top of what I already had in my mailbox, and it was clearly organized. So we had a very serious discussion in this parliament whether we would have to be the victims of this pressure, so to speak, that we were actually up against. And I think this is certainly a serious question, because what can these medias be used for, and how can we be sure that we are up against a real opinion, if you ask me about this? I mean, many of these things were obviously organized, but on the other hand, in the end, we recognized that we were talking about millions of people, so we of course took this into consideration when we dealt with the matter. But my question, and now I'm coming finally to a question to the panel, is how do you think that we should react in the future? Because this will, of course, not be the first time we experience a thing like that. And I'm not trying to avoid it. I'm not trying to talk against it. But I would like parliaments and parliamentarians and users in all to find a way forward, so we can kind of hopefully qualify the discussion on the social medias a bit more than it's been done in this case. I hope that you will react on this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Løkkegaard, for your contribution and your question. And who would like to answer?
I'll take this one. As regards to the sort of onslaught of emails about ACTA And how you should respond to that and deal with it, I think it's just a matter of learning judgment about being able to tell whether or not those thousands and thousands and thousands of emails and social media contacts are genuine or whether they've been manufactured by a small group. In the same way as we had to do with letter writing campaigns or fax campaigns or telephone campaigns, it's not surprising that this is confusing for people, because really we have to remember that we've only been using the internet, most people in Europe have only been using the internet for about 400 weekends. You know, it's not a very long time. We're still learning how to do this. So So of course you're going to need to, you know, have staff who can tell the difference, and you're going to need to employ some perhaps younger people, or you know, some brighter interns or whatever, who can look at it and say, well, that's obviously been generated by one lunatic in wherever, or this is the real thing. So yes, on the one hand, it's a matter of skills, but you also have to be aware that communicating over the internet, whether it's through social media or email, is the dominant way of communicating for many people now. It's the normal way of communicating. It's not unusual. You know, as a good example, the least used application on my phone is the phone, right? And so we have to be careful not to think that communication over social media or over email is somehow special, either more special than a letter or a phone call, or less relevant than a letter or a phone call. And we're just in that transition period now. But when you see a big spike, like we had with, you know, those particular copyright reform bills, if you find that you get huge amounts of response on a particular policy, and it hasn't been organized by a single group, if it turns out that everybody in this, you know, everybody in the parliament gets thousands and thousands of email every morning, then that's democracy happening. And that's usually a symptom that the thing you're debating in parliament really sucks. You know?
Thank you, Ben. And Heather would like to add something.
Can I answer your question more broadly? Because I think Ben covered ACTA very well. I've wanted to discuss what we can learn from what different grassroots. And there's been a lot of, or at least to me, slagging off of citizen journalists. And yes, we do have to make sure that what is published, whether it's on the internet or in print or on the radio or television, is following the highest codes of professional journalism, which is neutrality, accuracy, and of course intelligence. There are whole grassroots networks that have developed since the unfolding of the Arab Spring, and these networks are made up of citizen journalists. And I wish the person from the BBC was still here. I wish Helen was here, because she wanted to have an adult discussion about this, and I would have welcomed that very much. But in Egypt, a group of professional journalists, Egyptian journalists, got together, and it was a time when there was a lot of the violence and the demonstrations, and foreign journalists were getting into the country, but then they were being violated against and they had to leave. So there weren't as many journalists on the ground as could have been. And what was happening in their country, was important. They wanted the world to know about it. So they set up this network, these professional journalists and editors of check desks at certain points throughout Cairo, and then expanded out to other parts of Egypt. And they basically trained citizen journalists who were just as passionate about recording what was happening in their country as they were, and they trained them either in person, or they now have an online program which is being replicated, which I don't have with me, but I'm very happy to talk to people and share it with them, of training online, citizen journalists to be able to go out to report on what's taking place. So many times in these countries, it's the citizen journalists that are the only ones that are there in the situation, and they can report on it, how to do it accurately and professionally. And then they send it back to what's called a check desk, and that information is gone through and analyzed to make sure it's accurate, and then sent on to wherever it's going to be published. So that's one example, I think a very good example, of grassroots using citizen journalism to its best and working.
Thank you very much. Yes, please, Mr. Lokegaard, another contribution or question.
Well, I don't know if there's room for debate here, but I'll try with just one additional remark to what Mr. Hammersley has already said. I totally agree. That's why we ended up by actually following the protest, because we had a we had a sincere discussion about what really matters here and the concerns of all these protesters. But my point is also that there's a fear, I think there's a genuine fear of being overrun by the technology part of this, if you understand. For instance, at some point I realized that a Danish minister for trade was actually hacked by some of these guys and at her website producing false press statements. Yeah, that's funny, I know, but we had a sound laugh about this. But on the other hand, if you have tried the same thing as a minister, I think you would be quite disappointed by what's happening. I mean, this is surely methods that we don't want to use in journalism. We don't want to use it. We have a lot of talk here about the principles, and we are on the high horse, all of us, I guess. But here we are in a room of technology and skills that we simply have to face up to this challenge. Also, that's my point.
Okay, thank you very much.
But okay.
We are moving to our fifth panelist because time is running and we don't have enough time. So and thank you very much for your contribution. And our fifth speaker is Verica Rupper. Verica Rupper is an academic consultant in Media Diversity Institute in London. She teaches international journalism at Cardiff School of Journalism, Media and Cultural Studies in Welsh, UK. So take the floor.
Kusen im Sepen.
How? How can you speak Hungarian?
Yes, I do. Just one sentence I can't resist not to respond. If there is a fear, the fear should be around the nature of political communication, not around the technology and media format between which it is happening. But I'm not going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about the best journalism practice in reporting diversity across Europe. And I will try to address the question how mainstream journalism, conventional, traditional journalism, journalism practice in so-called old media, print, TV and radio, meets the challenges imposed by different forms of information gathering, processing and presenting in the digital world. I will draw upon the study Getting the Facts Right, Reporting Ethnicity and Religion in 9 European Union Countries, produced by the Media Diversity Institute in cooperation with the International Federation of Journalists and Article 19. The study is part of the wider project Ethical Journalism Initiative, campaign to fight racism and discrimination through the highest professional standards of journalism, and is funded by the European Union and the Open Society Foundations. The study is indicative of the ways journalists approach the complexity of increasingly diverse Europe, increasingly diverse European Union, diverse in terms of economies, of political stability, of understanding of democracy, but also diverse in terms of ethnicity, religion, gender, to name just 3 categories that this study focused on. The team of the Media Diversity Institute researchers has interviewed editors and journalists in the mainstream, conventional, traditional media in the UK, Denmark, Germany, France, Greece, Italy, Lithuania, Hungary and Slovakia, trying to figure out, A, how can we help journalists, media researchers and relevant civil society organizations better understand the way in which the professional orientation of journalists across Europe could influence their approach to the idea of inclusive society, society for all and society of all. How media can contribute to fighting racism and xenophobia in the countries covered by the project, and how to tackle discrimination and improve media coverage of ethnic and religious minorities in society. I won't go into details of these studies. Some copies were available this morning at the reception desk, and the full study is available on the Media Diversity website and also on the website of the International Federation of Journalists. But I would like to focus on a couple of points that came out of this study in form of its recommendations. Firstly, all newsmakers interviewed in the study agree that the most important principles in journalism are, already mentioned, accuracy, fairness, balance, and objectivity. Yet, a vast majority of them say that media, unfortunately, play a crucial role in spreading prejudice and stereotypes. So, who is doing that bad job then? If these main principles of fairness, accuracy, balance, and objectivity are obliged by all journalists and media still are arena for hate speech, who is doing that work? Secondly, majority of people we interviewed, and there were 117 journalists and editors, agreed that the main obstacles to good reporting are poor financial state of the media, the absence of dialogue between media owners and, on the other side, editors and journalists, overloading of reporters, lack of time, lack of knowledge about anti-discriminatory legislation, and lack of in-house training. If we look now at different digital forms of news gathering, processing, and presenting, we see how some of these obstacles simply disappear. For example, lack of specialist knowledge. Many of the civil society organizations, and Heather talked about that, their websites produce high-quality information about the discrimination against certain ethnic and religious groups. At the same time, providing this information that is necessary for functioning of the democracy can be also one-sided, can be, as we all know, spinned, can be just one element in the full story about the issue that that we are talking about. Some audience research also shows, and I'm talking about these open questions around these new forms of news gathering and presenting information. Some academic studies have shown that people go to the internet to actually confirm their already existing opinions, looking for the sites that will bring new details for the argument that they are making, either about the political issue or any other social issues in the society. If we turn around the coin and look at the best of journalism practice, which I like to do, because I think that that can be inspiring and that can give us the examples how we can move forward. So if we look at the best of journalism practices identified in this study, we can see that what counts as good journalism today has actually already opened the door to the tools that are brought by new media in reporting ethnicity and religion and in reporting any other social issue. We ask journalists to nominate examples of the best and the worst of journalism practice when it comes to covering ethnicity and religion. And we found that the best journalism goes beyond already existing frames in reporting on these issues. So writing about ethnicity and religion not only in relation to crime or social unrest or political conflicts. Fascinating examples across Europe can be found. For example, new forms of community engagement, some of the examples from the UK we heard this morning. A revival of undercover reporting in Germany, Lithuania, Denmark, France. Special blogs, websites and supplements run by the mainstream media, but that provide a platform for better engagement with the audience, for the more open dialogue with those who need information in order to be free and self-governing. Best journalism practices are based on closer comparison, but not anymore cooperation between journalists and powerful sources, because that's what that conventional, traditional journalism tends to do, but on the relationship, bit closer relationship between journalists and different social society, civil society organizations. Analysis of the examples of good coverage show that good journalism means, in the, and I will list this because it gives it can encourage our thinking about coexistence that we experience all with, of all the new media. Good journalism means in-depth reporting, providing background information, considering the impact, giving a voice to the voiceless, avoiding stereotypes, showing respect, taking a stand on discrimination, engaging with the audience, being transparent in mediating reality for the audience, as Peščanik is doing, and I am one of their regular readers. My final point, and thank you so much for staying this late, is that good journalism, being mainstream or user-generated content or citizen journalism or digital journalism, however you name it, means treating the World Wide Web as a source of information, as information gathering tool, and as a medium itself. A new media platform that A media platform, not new anymore, a media platform that offers a range of new opportunities to combine audiovisual and written information and produce journalism that matters. And journalism that matters is the thing that the society needs.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Veljko, for your presentation. And we have time, one or for two questions. I was told we have time. No? No time? Okay. Yes, the gentleman. Okay.
Yes, thank you. I would like to ask you about the opinion, or maybe the statement, that Mr. Miloš Ćirić said about the situation in Serbia, because he told a lot of interesting things, but one of them was especially interesting. He said that in Serbia they have some kind of illusion of pluralism. They have a lot of newspapers, a lot of TV stations, and a lot of other radio medium, but they all say the same. And I would like to ask the panelists, how to deal with such situation when the legal regulations are met, where everything is okay in looking at from the law perspective, but we still have no real pluralism. We have fiction in the area of pluralism. How to deal with such situation? And I'm not only asking about the legal regulations, but some kind of other solutions, maybe. Thank you.
Okay, on behalf of the panelists, Verica will answer you.
I'm afraid it has to be quite a general answer. So there are different forms of supporting media pluralism in terms of content and not only in terms of the ownership. What Serbia is experiencing is what majority of countries in former Eastern and Central Europe were experiencing, a wild form of capitalism and neoliberalism, opening the gates for plurality of the ownership models, but actually cementing the situation where the elites dictates what the media content is. So what is the solution for that is to strengthen journalists' organizations, to support independent media, to open a dialogue about the press performance, to introduce the institutions and arenas for evaluation journalism practice. And by talking about the work that is done, maybe there will be a chance that it can be improved fast.
Okay. Thank you. Ben. Ben would like to add something. Just 1 second.
Very, very quickly. I think
one of the things that's very necessary for media pluralism in any of these countries. As was said, this is quite a common thing across Eastern Europe and other parts of the world as well, is also to not wait for the European Union to do something. But the way to have a pluralistic media is to have more media and fight for it and build it and tell all your friends to build it as well. It's the point about the internet. That it used to be said that, you know, the freedom of the press belongs to those who have a press. Well, we all have a press now. That's the point of the internet. So yes, it's difficult, and yes, politically and from a human safety point of view, it's very difficult, and Reporters Without Borders can undoubtedly give you some advice on that, but the way to have a pluralistic media is to start it.
Okay, the third panel is closed, and I thank our panelists for their excellent presentations, and thank all of you that you are here. And we are moving to the final and the last professional program of the media forum, the closing remarks. Thank you.
Yes, and just the final session, just if in the last 10 minutes, we are running behind time, but we have just some headline points regarding the themes of the day to be presented by Pierluigi Pacu, the director of the Center for Media Pluralism and Media Freedom in Florence, and Damian Tambini, the director at the London School of Economics, the Media Policy Project. So if I can just welcome them very briefly. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me start mentioning that we just finished last week the Summer School of Journalists organized by our new Center for Media Pluralism and Media Freedom, co-financed by the European Commission. There were 33 bright young people from 21 countries, from inside and outside the profession, from the border of the profession, and that shows that the impression we had, we learned a lot, and we had the impression that it's a profession that is alive and is fighting to adapt to a very complex new world. This is our third conference we co-organize in this period. The first was about pluralism, diversity, and hate speech with Frank LaRue. That is about equilibrium between media freedom and media and other important rights. The second was about methodology of measuring pluralism, because that's a major issue on which we have to find an understanding. The third is this one, that was essentially on many things, but also on new media, that is a new challenge. And probably the fourth thing we have to do, and we are doing, is this policy study for the Commission about EU competencies in report of media pluralism and media freedom. We'll do a fair draft by the end of July and a policy debate in October. Let me just go to 8 very, very quickly pills from this debate. Commissioner Kroes said that we need more Europe. But if we need more Europe, this is an area where more Europe doesn't cost anything, almost anything, and can give a great revenue in terms of unity and cohesion. Europe should strive to have the most lively and free media environment in the world. And this is our occasion. But we need a deeper understanding of why we are unhappy with present EU rules, why they are not enough, for instance, why competition rules may help but are not sufficient. These are the questions we have to ask. And if we are convinced that we need a specific European intervention, we should understand if we need a detailed rule or a few deep principles to follow. Personally, I prefer deep principles because they outlast short-sighted controversies and go closer to the heart of why we care about media pluralism and media freedom, that is the health of our democracies. Then we have to understand, if we find some few important principles, how can they become part of our acquis communautaire, which is the best way forward, as Neil Kroes was saying. And on this, and CMPF in Florence, we are trying to help the Commission to study. But let's add that all these issues are issues on which academia, journals, media practitioners have to give their contributions. But these are issues in the end that are issues for the citizens, because all should contribute and assume responsibility of this kind of teams. Because if media pluralism is important for democracy, then democracy is essentially a citizen issue. It's not an issue for technicians. And finally, I conclude with this. I want to steal a quote from a very small minority paper in Italy that has been there around for about 40 years, and now is fighting to survive, not to close for economical reason. And they have just started the subscription campaign with a slogan that I find very effective. The slogan is "Silent No," "Zitti No" in Italian. Well, I think that this is the right idea in the end for this conference. An issue like media pluralism and media freedom is an issue on which the voice should always be on and loud. Thank you.
Thank you, Gianluigi. Approximately 1 year ago, I received an email from somebody who I'd never met before. Her name was Siobhan Gray, and she asked me in her email whether I'd be interested in having a discussion about media pluralism and media freedom issues. And I said, yes, that's fascinating. We need to discuss this. The person you really need to speak to is called Peggy Welke. I don't think I was the only person that introduced these two people, but I have to say they've come an extremely long way since then, and I am extremely pleased to have been involved. But I'm just going to give briefly, because I know I'm standing between you and the reception, a couple of reflections on what we've learned today and the broader question, what can be done? The answer, I think, is that we've learned and we've done a lot already simply by being here. We've raised the profile of this range of issues and we've begun an exchange of experience. We've assessed the terrain in Europe and, crucially, we've begun to work on concepts and terminology. We heard this morning that the Strasbourg Court has never ruled on what is media pluralism, and I think we have a range of legal and policy experience across Europe that Peggy's work has begun to analyse, but we clearly still have some distance to go. We've learned that this is really a key moment of change and upheaval on a number of different levels. Structures and business models, the involvement and relationships of artists and IP holders, and the overall sustainability of all forms of content creation, including journalism, has been questioned. We've looked at a complex crisis also at the member state level. Different crises, indeed. The UK has been something of a theme. On this, I think I have to make one point of clarification. The link to the issue of media pluralism in the UK is not somehow that this is a form of regulation that would avoid any future repeat of phone hacking or other illegal activities. These are clearly against the law. The reason there is a link to the issue of media pluralism in the UK is because there was a cover-up and collusion between politicians and other and the police, and that it seems likely that this collusion and cover-up involved a fear of the media and was related to structural concentration of media power in a way that we're only beginning to understand. We also looked at Italy as another example, and this highlighted the complex nature of pluralism as a policy objective. Not only is it concerned with market structures, it's concerned with internal regulation of content and also, of course, the independence of the public service broadcaster. We had a moving description of a journalist's attempt to maintain independence in contemporary Russia, and a memorable reminder that media freedom and media independence can be worth taking fundamental risks for. At the policy level, I think we can see that this is a key historical moment, not only because of a crisis, but because of a number of processes that are going on. We have a citizen initiative, the attempt to gain a million signatures in the campaign for an EC directive on this issue. We have a high-level group going to report in the October. And we also have a longer tradition of activity both at the Council of Europe and at the European Commission. And we've had a clear signal today from the relevant commissioner that the doors are open for a debate. Key take-home message in relation to the work that the new centre in Florence is doing. It was quite striking that Commissioner Kroes didn't appear to have a clear view on what competencies are. She said there were two views. Some believe that the media market is too fragmented and local, and others believe that there are common principles at stake here that require the EU to be involved in defending them. So many other things will happen and are happening. Just a publicity break. I'm publishing a report at the London School of Economics Media Policy Project on Friday, which picks up a number of these issues. Our aim is to ensure at the member state level in the UK that issues of media concentration are indeed linked to the events surrounding the Leveson inquiry. But I think just in closing, if we want to look forward to what may come out of this debate, which may unify in some way the real range of experiences across Europe. Hugh Grant said in the UK we seem to have an example of media capture of the state, whereas in many other countries, and particularly outside Europe, there is an example of capture of the media by the state. That is a huge range of experiences which highlight the importance of independence of the media, and they also signal that there is a level of complexity which suggests no single solution will apply and raises the real fundamental question of what is the role of European institutions in all this. I'm not going to answer that. I'm sure Pierluigi is going to do a huge amount of work, as will my academic colleagues. But just make one note in closing. There is, a two-part test here. This has to be something where the EC actually has competence to deal with issues, but it also has to be something that there can be agreement on, widespread political agreement across Europe. There aren't many policy initiatives that will actually pass those two tests, but one which I think is potentially promising is the question of transparency. That's probably the theme, in my view, that unifies many of the discussions in terms of literacy, transparency of media ownership. If we are to repair trust in the media, we really need to understand who is behind the media, and a big part of that is media transparency. So on that note, I would like to ask you to thank the organisers, Peggy and Siobhan, in the traditional manner. I don't know if they want to say anything else, but I'd certainly like to ask you to thank them even before they do. Thank you.
Well, thank you, everybody. That is the end of the New Media Forum today. And this is the end of the beginning of the New Media Diversity debate. Of course, we have launched the forum here at the Hemicycle Debating Chamber, and that's a symbolic statement in itself. Of course, you can continue to follow us on the website at www.mediapluralism.eu. Now, of course, there's a reception to follow for the next couple of hours, and so the care of a number of sponsors, Alan and Overy, Freshfields, Allswangs, and Music Managers Forum. So, thanks to them, we will have the reception on the first floor in the Parliament's restaurant. So thank you very much indeed.